Savage, you've been in the past.
Yeah, and I'm sure the captain, but I think Jake Buxton there will have an input. You know, he's a warrior. He's come from a non-league football. I think 7 years ago he's played non-league football for Burton. He epitomises a spirit. You know, Derby have shown this season, so it's going to get underway. It's going to be a fantastic game. Good quality, greasy pitch, great support. Let's have it.
Champions League final coming up later at 7:45 on 5 Live from Lisbon. But this is a huge game at Wembley. It's Derby County against Queen's Park Rangers, and we're underway. And Derby playing from right to left. It's straight back to young Andre Wisdom, the defender on loan from Liverpool. And Queen's Park Rangers intercept the ball midway inside their own half. Little Will Hughes goes sliding into a challenge. And that surface will be wet, Robbie, after that enormous downpour. It's still raining, just not as heavily at the moment.
Yeah, it will be an interesting, as you said earlier, Connor, QPR 4-4-2. Doyle's played up there with Austin. Cranchier on the left. I'm sure Cranchier will float inside now again, try and get in the ball and, you know, in spaces, and that's where he's most dangerous.
Possession inside the centre circle with Junior Hoylett, the former Blackburn Rovers player. Good interception by Jake Buxton. Then Derby lose the ball. Queen's Park Rangers go long. And it's a strong header by the Derby captain, Richard Keogh, that clears it towards the halfway line. And a free kick has been awarded. And Derby will take it. Well, they look to take it quickly. A little bit too quickly for the referee's liking. So a reminder of the teams in full. Derby with Grant in goal. Back four, Wisdom, Buxton, Keogh and Forsyth. Three in midfield, Hughes, Thorne and Hendrick. And three up front, Russell, Martin and Ward. Chris Martin, 25 goals in all competitions this season. He scored in both legs of the semi-final. This is Hughes. Ball now played out towards Jamie Ward on the left-hand side of attack. And it's intercepted for Queen's Park Rangers. The ball is cleared away down the right wing. And just at the moment, up front, Kevin Doyle looks a little bit isolated as the Derby defenders very easily deal with it, and Derby move up to the halfway line once again.
It's going to be very important that in that QPR's midfield, that O'Neill and Barton against the three, Thorne, Hendrick and Hughes. You can't let Derby dictate there, but you know they're going to get outnumbered in their QPR, so it's important Joey Barton gets his influence on the game straight away.
2 minutes on the clock. Derby defending with Wisdom on the edge of the penalty area, put under pressure by Doyle, who surely was late as he lunged in there, edge of the penalty area. Wisdom clearing the ball away. Ball was well clear by the time Kevin Doyle connected with the feet of Wisdom, and a free kick is awarded to Derby, but there's no other sanction.
Yeah, it's going to be a tough afternoon for Chris Martin too, up against Onua and Dunn. Huge experience from Dunn there, not the quickest, so it's important when, you know, Russell and Ward link up with Martin up front.
Brilliant noise in here at Wembley. Hardly any empty seats around the stadium, one or two red plastic seats on view here and there, but it's a big crowd here. And a free kick to Queen's Park Rangers now, close to the halfway line. They've got Rob Green in goal, Danny Simpson, Ned Manua, Richard Dunn and Captain Clint Hill in the back four. O'Neill and Barton in the middle of midfield. Hoylett and Cranchar on the flanks. Charlie Austin and Kevin Doyle up front. And they've just wasted a set piece there. Launched way too far and straight out for a Derby goal kick. Just seen a shot of Steve McLaren down in the dugouts. He's had to take off his wet suit jacket. And he's replaced him with a sort of traditional padded waterproof manager's jacket to watch this game in more comfort. Goal kick for Lee Grant, wearing all grey. Long ball over the halfway line. Header though won by Joey Barton. Derby get it back again, down on the deck. And this is Keogh to his right-hand side, is Wisdom. And up to Will Hughes on the halfway line, immediately surrounded by three Queen's Park Rangers players. But it's worked well to Russell. Johnny Russell down the right wing, gets away from two defenders, runs now across the edge of the penalty area. Then there's a challenge on the edge of the D. Hughes is going to try and get control of it, but Queen's Park Rangers have done enough to halt that particular Derby momentum. It will, however, be a free kick to Derby County in a shooting position just outside the penalty area.
Yeah, feisty start. Great run from Johnny Russell. I think the referee should have given a free kick early on, but because Johnny Russell stayed on his feet with no advantage, the ref played on. If Johnny Russell goes down there, he gives a free kick. The free kick eventually given for a foul on Will Hughes in a fantastic position now, 25 yards out, where it'll be the left foot of Russell, the right foot of Jamie Ward.
So Derby County 0, Queen's Park Rangers 0, the early stages at Wembley of this championship playoff final, and the first dangerous attacking set piece of the game. Rob Green, the Queen's Park Rangers goalkeeper, lining up his wall. What must his thoughts be in a World Cup year? Remember, 4 years ago, Rob Green was England's first choice goalkeeper going into that World Cup in South Africa, dropped that clanger against the United States, was then dropped from the team and never made it back. Here comes the free kick, clips the top of the wall, and Queen's Park Rangers have been able to clear the ball away. Robbie Savage.
Yeah, terrible free kick from Russell there, no power on it, but that's going to be an interesting battle. Russell against Clinton Hill. Clinton Hill left back, not great at left back. Russell coming inside on his favourite left foot, which will be Clinton Hill's right. That's going to be great, but as is Hoyle against Forsyth, and this, I think Hoyle's got great pace. If you have his QPR, try and get the ball to as much as I could.
Ball played down the left-hand side for Derby, intended for Jamie Ward to sprint after, but he doesn't get there ahead of Neda Manua, and Queen's Park Rangers clear it away to the halfway line. This is Danny Simpson, former Manchester United and Newcastle defender, plays it over the halfway line. Wisdom intercepts for Derby and turns and calmly rolls it back to Lee Grant. He only turned 21 earlier on this month, Andre Wisdom. He looks to be a mature head on young shoulders and might well have a chance of breaking into the Liverpool team next season, having now got games under his belt on loan at Derby. Here comes an attack for Hoyland, down the right-hand side for Queen's Park Rangers, and Craig Forsyth's tackle puts the ball out for the first corner of the game. Corner to Queen's Park Rangers on the right-hand side. It is 0-0 on 5-line.
Positive start from both teams. The wingers getting the ball, running their respective full-backs. Good start from both teams.
Joey Barton's the player who's come across to place the ball for the corner, and he's getting all sort of stick from the Derby fans who are housed at this end of the stadium. It's split 50-50 down the middle in terms of the allocation, and Barton now just been asked to wait for a moment while the referee has a word with some tussling players in the penalty area. Queen's Park Rangers have sent a lot of players forward. Derby have got everyone back inside the penalty area in the D. Now Barton with the bright orange boots, a short run up, plays it in, right footed, good delivery, might have struck an arm in there as it careered across the penalty area and eventually goes out for a throw into Queen's Park Rangers on the far side.
I thought it was handball from a Derby player, I thought it was Wisdom.
Throw-in's been taken quickly, here comes the cross from the far side, and again it's overstruck from Thorne, and that goes out for a goal kick to Derby, yeah, away to our right hand side.
It's a high driven ball to the back post. I think Dunnan or Onua had a run on the centre halves, and you know, the question is, was there an arm? I thought Wisdom raised his arm. He might have been a foul. Yet to see a replay, but I thought, you know, possibly could have been a handball.
So we've yet to have a proper attempt on target in the game. 0-0 on 5-life. Good control there from Charlie Austin. And he shoots from a long, long way out. He must have been 10, 12 yards outside the penalty area. It was dipping, but just not enough for Charlie Austin. 20 goals this season, despite a lengthy injury absence. And that was the first proper shot in anger of the game.
Yeah, and that's where the benefit of playing two up front. You know, Doyle will get hold of one centre-half, and then Austin will drop into a little space and allow to get on the half two, and he done that, brushed off Thorne, good strength, you know, I think 35 yards out, tried from there but over the bar. But that's good about playing two up front. You can drop into them little pockets of space and get on the half two.
Here come Derby, chance down the left hand side. This is Russell into the penalty area, sends in a cross, nearly troubled the goalkeeper of the back post, but Rob Green was very aware, knew his angles, and just let it sail over his head, knowing it would go wide of the post and out for a goal kick to Queen's Park Rangers. 0-0.
You've got to say, no nerves from either side. I think they both look comfortable in the ball. They're both getting tackles in. You know, they're trying to get the ball to Russell, who's now swapped wings with Jamie Ward. Jamie Ward's gone to the right, Russell's come to the left. You know, and Hoyler against Forsyth. No nerves at all on the pitch. It's been a great start to the game from both teams.
Well, you made the point, Robbie, before kickoff. You look at the names in the Queen's Park Rangers squad, and they shouldn't have to have come through this playoff process, should they? I mean, there should have been enough talent in there to go up automatically. But Queen's Park Rangers are doing it the hard way here. And for many times this season, I've seen Queen's Park Rangers quite a bit. They've looked like individuals rather than a team. And it's been difficult for Harry Redknapp to get all these, okay, players with a lot of Premier League experience, but to get them to roll up their sleeves and play as a team in the Championship.
Well, that's his job, though. He's got to do that. You know, Phil will have a better thing than that as a manager for me. But yeah, they are individuals, but these individuals, this is the big stage for them. You know, so many people are watching. You know, it's Wembley Stadium, the chances of going to the Premier League. If they're going to turn up today, it'll be a good thing.
The first 3 months of the season, Steve McLaren was a coach at Loftus Road under Harry Redknapp. How much of that is an advantage to him today that he knows these players?
Yeah, well, no, of course. You'll probably try and give each Derby player a DVD or, you know, but as a player, you should know you're going to be playing against. You don't need a manager to tell you. You know, you should be watching your football yourself. So on the day, though, anything can happen.
It's 0-0 on 5 Live. Coming up next month, 24 days of live football commentaries from the World Cup in Brazil, including every England game live. We've got exclusive access to the England team hotel, and BBC Radio 5 Live will be the home of Brazil 2014. Here come Queen's Park Rangers down the right-hand side. Austin fails to control a long pass, and he raises up a hand of acknowledgement, but it's going to be a throw into Derby County.
Yeah, Jake Buxton there, he's got a habit of, you know, trying to win balls unnecessarily there. I think it was Doyle who dropped off, and Jake Buxton's never going to win the ball. Doyle wins it to Austin. Austin couldn't control it, but there, that would have been a chance. You know, Buxton's got a habit of trying to win balls where he can't.
It's still raining at Wembley. Not anywhere like the downpour we had just before kick-off as the two teams lined up for the national anthems. And this is Sam Simpson, who's been charged down by Johnny Russell, who now chased towards the penalty area but beaten to it by Nedumanua, and he puts the ball out of play. Two former Manchester City defenders at the heart of the Queen's Park Rangers defence in Richard Dunn and Nedumanua.
Yeah, I think Derby try and press QPR high up the pitch because I think they got mistakes in them. You know, Simpson, Onua, Dunn, Clint Hill. If you can press them high up the pitch with the legs you've got in that team, you know, you can nick the ball high up and have a chance on goal.
This is Johnny Russell, who is Derby's most expensive signing over the last year. He only cost £750,000. He's got possession again, midway inside the Queen's Park Rangers half, left-hand side of the field, up towards the edge of the penalty area, and the striker, Chris Martin, just releases it back again. Forsyth is up from left-back, tries to play it in low, looking for Martin. Well intercepted, though, by Gary O'Neill, and Queen's Park Rangers clear away to the halfway line, and a strong challenge comes in, and a free kick will be awarded to Queen's Park Rangers for that challenge on Charlie Austin. So we're up and running at Wembley. It's still 0-0. What are your early thoughts, Phil Brown?
Connor, it's a great start to a game that's worth £130 million. When you think about that, I don't think that's shown too much nerves. I think what I did see, I know I made mention and reference to Derby County in the warm-up, how they were standing off each other. My word, they weren't standing off each other in the first 3 minutes. I think we heard the referees whistle six or seven times for free kicks. So both sides are fully committed. I think Robbie's nailed it with regards to each winger's had a little run at the fullback and a little test to see if he can get after, you know, who's got the strength, who's got the weaknesses, where they lie. They're just trading punches at the moment, and I think it'll settle into a cracking game of football, but it's interesting, the two systems. I think at the moment, Derby's system, for me, is just edging it. The 4-3-3 over the 4-4-2.
Well, thanks very much, Phil. By the way, in the Rugby Union European Qualification Playoff second leg, it's now Stade Francais Wasps 10. That is the latest scoreline. Robbie Savage.
And what QPR doing from Derby's goal kicks? I know Derby like to get the ball out and play, but they're pushing three on, so they're stopping Derby playing out from the back from goal kicks. They're making Grant kick the ball on.
We've played 13 minutes on 5 Live. Phil Brown mentioned there the financial rewards on offer here. According to the analyst Deloitte, this game worth £120 million to Derby, £80 million to Queen's Park Rangers. The reason there's a difference is because if Queen's Park Rangers don't go up, they would still continue to receive parachute payments from their relegation last season, whereas if Derby don't go up, they wouldn't have that finance. So for Derby, the finances on offer even greater than for Queen's Park Rangers, but given the debt that Queen's Park Rangers have worked their way into and the implications of financial fair play these days, Queen's Park Rangers really do need to get up and get into the Premier League bank accounts. This is Russell, left-hand side for Derby. He's done well to lay the ball back into Hendrick. Now a chance of a cross from the left-hand side, and again, Robert Green was very confident, didn't even stretch for it, confident it was going to go above his head and out for a goal kick to Queen's Park Rangers. 0-0.
That's where I think they missed Bryson. You know, great build-up play. Diagonal ball from Keogh. Forsyth won the header to Martin, who's then not in the box. Laid the ball out. Forsyth then crosses it, nobody in the box. That's where they missed the run of Bryson. Bryson's got so many goals from doing that run into the box this year. That's why I'm surprised he's not started.
Yes, Craig Bryson, who only missed one league game in the regular championship season, contributed 16 goals from midfield. He scored two hat-tricks this season, Bryson. He is on the bench, but he's not been 100% fit. Here's Austin again down the other end for Queen's Park Rangers. Turns around the defender, Keogh, who takes him down on the edge of the penalty area. And that is a free kick to Queen's Park Rangers in shooting distance.
Again, I'm sure Phil's picked up on this. Jake Buxton keeps trying to win the ball in stupid areas. He's trying to go over the top of the centre forward. He comes out of the space. That leaves Austin in bags and bags of room. You know, even if he wins the ball, Doyle from a flick on, if you stay there, you're going to get collect the ball yourself. So Jake Buxton, if I was Steve McClaren, I'd be shouting to Buxton, listen, just if you're not going to win the ball, and that's three times now he's either given away a foul or lost the header. Stay in your position in them areas.
That's the voice of Robbie Savage, former Derby captain, former Wales international, watching this game of this year at Wembley on 5 Live. 0-0 in the Sky Bet Championship playoff final. Free kick has been awarded to Queen's Park Rangers. Joey Barton's having a good look at this. Nico Kranjčar as well. It's about four or five paces outside the penalty area. The wall is erected inside. Kranjčar runs over it. Barton shoots, hits the top of the wall, and it is going to go out for a throw-in on the far side.
Yeah, two poor free kicks. The first one was from Johnny Russell, that one from Joey Barton there. No elevation, hit the wall. Was never looked like he was going to score, really. Either player didn't, so, but again, good positive start from both teams.
Kranjčar gives it into the penalty area. Could be a chance in there for Kevin Doyle. He just lost his footing as he tried to control and turn all in one motion, and the ball skipped away from him. But it just shows, just like that, in the blink of an eye, opportunities can come in big games like this. Still 0-0 on 5 Live from the BBC. Derby, who finished the season in third place, which if you go back down through the years, statistically, that's been the position that you've been most likely to then go on and win the playoffs in. But Queen's Park Rangers won't be too worried by that. This is Kranjčar on the halfway line. Nice little drag back to himself there. And then a strong challenge comes crunching in from George Thorne. But Derby can't regain possession. Good, stern play from both teams. And Nua has it here for Queen's Park Rangers. Right-hand side, stubs the ball forward. Up towards Kevin Doyle. Last touch came off him. And a throw into Derby County. Left fullback position for them.
Yeah, these are the days you miss your playing greasy service. Challenges going in fair and square, 50-50. That one there between Austin and Hendrick. You know, two committed players. You know, great challenge. And it's been a fantastic start. Great atmosphere. You know, but I think now we need to see some quality from somebody. Looking on that pitch there, Kranjčar's the one for me who's got that extra bit of something, you know, and Will Hughes has got great feet as well. But looking at out there, Kranjčar's the one who now just needs to start to dictate, add that bit of quality. That's what's missing now.
I think the rain has stopped, if not just the tiniest of drizzles down there now. This is Doyle, edge of the penalty area, shoots low, left footed, comes off the shins of Andre Wisdom, goes out for a throw into Queen's Park Rangers on the far side.
They're definitely in the ascendancy now. As I said, that little bit of quality from Kranjčar, you can, the first 5 or 10 minutes, find your feet, winning tackles, bit, you know, there was no nerves really, but now Kranjčar just starting to get on the ball and make things happen.
17 and a half minutes played. Kranjčar tries to crack one in from the outskirts of the penalty area. It rebounds to Joey Barton and he doesn't catch that right at all. He went for a spectacular volley, but he's not been able to connect with it properly, and the ball goes out for a goal kick to Derby away to our right hand side. So 18 minutes on the clock, 0-0 here at Wembley Stadium between Derby County and Queen's Park Rangers. Huge prize on offer to move up to the Premier League next season. Let's go to Wentworth, the BMW PGA Championship, round 3, Ian Carter.
And a big move from the two-time champion Luke Donald with the only eagle of the day so far. He holds from the front of the green on the par 5, fourth. It moves him to 8 under par into a share of second place with Thomas Bjorn, one behind the leader, Shane Lowry of Ireland, 9 under par, playing the fourth.
Thanks very much, Ian. Well, Queen's Park Rangers here, who were relegated from the Premier League last season, and only twice in the past as a team been relegated from the Premier League and then gone back up the very next season through the playoffs. Leicester did it in 96, West Ham did it 2 years ago in 2012. Of course, many times teams just go back up in the automatic top two places. Good defending by Queen's Park Rangers here, getting the ball under control on the edge of their penalty area, and it's cleared away by Anua up towards Austin, challenged well by Buxton that time, but Derby are struggling to get the ball here in midfield. Barton turns and tries to spray it out to the right wing. Good interception by Forsyth for Derby, and then they lose it around the edge of the Queen's Park Rangers box. Barton again, and the referee is actually going to bring play to a halt here because there's an injury to a Derby player over on the far side of the pitch, and it doesn't appear to be a head injury, so I'm not quite sure whether referee Lee Mason have stopped this, but he's obviously decided it's of a serious enough nature to need to do so.
you look at the first 15 minutes, I think QPR would probably be happier. The game slowed down a bit. You know, the adrenaline's probably calmed down. And I think looking at Cranchard, Joey Barton, just starting to get their foot on the ball, you know, and just nice balls into the centre forward. They look a bit more composed. As Derby, they look, you know, somebody in that team now, looking around the team, not that much experience in it. You know, get your foot on the ball, get the ball into Thorne, into Hughes, Hendrick, try and play a few triangles, try and keep possession. But what QPR are doing well, they're pressurising high up the park, they're not letting them play out easy. You know, they're putting three up front, you know, when they've got easy possession, and they're stopping them playing out. So good tactics from Harry Redknapp.
Still 0-0, about to get back underway after that treatment for George Thorne. He's okay. And a goal kick to Rob Green, away to our left-hand side. Derby County 0, Queen's Park Rangers 0. Last year, it was Crystal Palace who beat Watford in this game. Now, the year before, Blackpool who beat West Ham. Reading beat Swansea the previous year to that. And one set of these supporters is going to go home very happy this evening. The other is going to be completely dejected. Long, long campaign to get to this stage, and it all comes down to this. Hoylett into the penalty area, right-hand side for Queen's Park Rangers, cuts back a low cross. Austin rolls it back to Barton, and Queen's Park Rangers still have the ball, but they're now 5-6 yards outside the penalty area. Played by Cranchar, back to Barton again, floats one into the penalty area. Simpson sprinted and stretched, but he couldn't get there. And there's applause for the Queen's Park Rangers fans, but it's gone out for a goal kick to Derby.
He's the danger for QPR, Hoylett. Great pace. He was a young boy at Blackburn when I was there. He was just coming through, and he came with the first team a few times when he was just, I think, 15. You know, he's never really, really kicked on, but, you know, what an opportunity today. Him against Forsyth, he's a real, real threat. You know, in a team of QPR where there's no real pace, he's the one that can really do something. Cranchard's got great feet, you know, on the other side, but Hoyle's the one-on-one situation. Can he get out Forsyth? He's done that on two occasions and beaten twice.
Yeah, so much Premier League experience in this Queen's Park Rangers team and in their squad. It's actually a great distinction between the resources available to the two clubs. If you look at the number of Premier League appearances between them, Derby County and their squad, a total of 170 Premier League appearances. Queen's Park Rangers, 4,264. It's a massive gulf of experience, and it just shows why, well, they probably shouldn't have been relegated in the first place, and they are finding it very hard to come out of the Championship despite all that experience of playing at a higher level. Derby doing well here in defence. That ball played away by Johnny Russell, controlled now in midfield by Jeff Hendrick. Worked out through Jamie Ward to Wisdom, who's got a bit of space now on the right-hand side. Ward is pushed to the ground off the ball. Close to referee Lee Mason, who waves play on. Now Queen's Park Rangers can launch a counter-attack. They've won it back on the halfway line. There's a push on Kevin Doyle, and play on, says the referee. And now Derby come over the halfway line, and their fans are on their feet. Will Hughes on the right-hand side with the bright yellow blonde hair gives the ball back in field to Hendrick. He's made a surge to the edge of the penalty area. Wisdom is wide on the right-hand side. Queen's Park Rangers desperately falling back into a defensive system now. Wisdom with a chance to cross on the right-hand side, and eventually sends in a cross. It's a poor ball over all of his teammates, and harmlessly goes out for a goal kick. Great passage of play.
Yeah, again, Cranchard winning the ball in midfield, give the ball to Doyle. I think the referee got it right. I think Doyle went to the ground far too easy there. Thorne won the ball, drove forward, but again, quality in the final third for Derby is lacking. You know, Wisdom with the ball into the box, poor cross. They just seem to, at the minute, Derby, okay midfield. When the ball goes up to Martin, they have no runners. Nobody's run past him once yet. You know, poor quality in the final third.
We've got the Champions League final coming up at 7:45 this evening on 5 Live. Derby have won a corner here on the left, played by Jamie Ward off Junior Hoylett. Corner to Derby. Playoffs, of course, tomorrow and Monday here at Wembley. We'll be all over them on 5 Live. And then the football takes the back seat just for a couple of weeks until the World Cup kicks off, and 5 Live will be the home of Brazil 2014. Here comes the corner for Derby, played in from the left-hand side. Richard Dunn with a commanding header, and he clears it back out to the left-hand side for Derby. Swung back into the box. That's a really good cross to the back post, and a chance, but it goes away off target. It was Craig Forsyth, the left-back, who just stole in at the back post there. Brilliant cross to find him, and his header is marginally too high.
Yeah, what a ball from Jamie Ward on this left-hand side. Whips it in with his right foot to the back post. And what Forsyth has got to do there? He's not going to score from there. He's got to knock it back across the goal for a runner from midfield. He didn't do that. He went for the target, you know, over the bar. But again, you know, you can't give Jamie Ward time out there because he has got great quality from you know, not from dead balls. It was a dead ball from the corner, but when the ball goes back to him.
24 minutes on the clock. Derby enjoying a better spell here. Ward again crosses from the left-hand side, but too far in front of Will Hughes, who'd made a really good run.
See, I think that's where this we're saying again about Bryson. I think there, Will Hughes hasn't quite got the energy, the legs to get onto the end of that. But Bryson, you know, I think he can play that into his path, you know, but it's the McLaren's call. Will Hughes had a terrific season, young player of the year in the championship. You know, I think if the game's at 0-0, 65 minutes, I think we'll see Bryson coming on.
Free kick awarded to Derby, close to the halfway line, still 0-0. I mentioned the forthcoming World Cup, some great programmes to whet the appetite of the run-up to it here on 5 Live, including the greatest World Cup 11, the ultimate guide to World Cup penalty shootouts. There's going to be a 5 Live World Cup quiz and a programme 11 moments that shocked the World Cup. Plenty of special programmes coming up here on 5 Live between now and the start of the tournament in just a few weeks' time. Here comes Queen's Park Rangers, Joey Barton, right-footed clearance over the halfway line, and Charlie Austin challenged in the air by Jake Buxton, and the ball carries on through back to Lee Grant. Let's bring Phil Brown back in again here. Phil?
It's a fascinating counter for me. I mean, tactically, both sides have got it right. You know, I think Derby had a spell for 10 minutes now. QPR had a spell for 10 minutes. The most important thing for me is them moments. And we haven't really had any clear-cut chances, but their moments will come in set pieces. You know, when you've got an opportunity to put a quality ball into the opposition's box and you've got goal scorers. I keep on saying this. When you've got goal scorers on the field of play, the chances fall to Martin and Austin. Then they're going to put the ball in the back of the net when them chances come. But I think it's going to take, you know, it's going to be maybe 60, 65 minutes before anybody in terms of management plays the hand to the next extent.
Yeah. Well, thanks, Phil. Charlie Austin, 20 goals this season for Queen's Park Rangers. Kevin Doyle, who only joined in January, scored 2 goals in his first 3 games, hasn't scored since. Here's a chance for Derby. Hughes into the penalty area, left hand side. He turns and he's pushed to the ground, and what a penalty! And the referee, Lee Mason, says no. And there's huge appeals, not just for the Derby players, but their spectators are up in arms all around us, and they feel that Will Hughes was challenged off the ball in the penalty area there. It was a brilliant, almost Cruyff turn in the box, and Richard Dunn surely snaps his ankles.
Well, is there contact there? That's the thing you've got. We're lucky we've got a monitor. It's a great run for Will Hughes. He does a little Cruyff turn. I think Dunn's caught him on the knee, and then Will Hughes has gone down a bit too late. It's a big call from the referee. Some referees will give that, some won't. But Dunn has, you know, it's great trickery from Will Hughes. It was a great run, and that's what I said. Derby can hurt QPR with midfield runners. Hughes there, there's contact. Will Hughes, his falls a bit late. You know, it's a 50-50 call. I'm going to say penalty.
Well, Richard Dunn, who's one of the biggest men on the pitch, big barrel chest on him, up against Will Hughes, who looks like a puff of wind would blow him over. He's a very slight young lad. And Dunn with the challenge. Hughes hitting the ground in the penalty area. On such little moments can playoff finals lie.
You've got to look at the centre-half in that situation. First thing Richard Dunn was put his both arms in the air to say, I didn't touch him, ref. That's a signal that he has.
Yeah, exactly. The instinct, yeah. That's Robbie Savage. Great to have him alongside us here at Wembley for this championship playoff final, which is nervy and tension-filled so far, and there haven't been too many clear-cut chances, but one huge slice of controversy there with a penalty appeal for Derby. A very much justified appeal, but not given. Here's a chance for Ward. Has a goal from distance. Now they're appealing. It hits an arm. Referee says that will be a corner. Corner to Derby, who have definitely improved, Robbie Savage.
Well, what they've done, you can see they've got more energy, more legs in the team. They're closing people down. They're hunting impact. That was 4 players there who crowded out Cranshaw. Ward got the break. Good strike. Good defending from Dunn. Such strong. It's hit him on the arm, yes, but his arms are near his body, so no free kick. It's gone to the corner.
And here comes that delivery. played in by Ward, comes straight back out to him. Derby have eight players in the box, and at the second attempt, it's put out for another corner and a corner to Derby on the right-hand side. It is still 0-0 here on 5 Live.
Yeah, you can just see the energy. Derby have grown in confidence, as Phil said. They had a spell early on, then QPR, but now QPR not in the game. Derby have got, you know, so much energy, so much drive and determination. They're hunting in numbers, you know, and they're doing it well. If one player goes to shut the ball down, somebody else goes behind him, and they're doing exceptionally well, Derby, at the minute.
Jake Buxton has gone forward from centre half up into the penalty area. He's only scored two goals this season. Here comes the delivery, played in by Russell. Not a good corner, cleared away at the front post. Derby get it back again in midfield, and there's a chance now for Ward, who lays it off to Russell. Crossing position on the right hand side for Derby. They come back into the centre. Hendrick quickly closed down by Hoylett, who's got lightning pace. Now on the edge of the penalty area, Chris Martin, who has not really been in the game, the top goal scorer for Derby. Now Queen's Park Rangers caught in possession. Austin's given it away on the edge of the box. Low ball in. Richard Dunn saves. Queen's Park Rangers sliding in on the edge of his 6-yard box, and right behind him was Chris Martin ready to pounce.
QPR all over the place. Said before the game, Derby's best chance will be pressurising high up. There's mistakes in that QPR team at the back, and they're giving the ball away. You know, Derby in the ascendancy, definitely good time to score a goal. Yep, but look at the work right here from Derby.
Yeah, both teams in it at the moment. 0-0 on 5 Live. Looking at the body language of some spectators not too far away from us, and it's concerned expressions on the faces of both. So much is riding on this game, and not much between the teams on the pitch so far in terms of performance. Here comes Danny Simpson over the halfway line. Ahead of him is Hoylett, now level with the penalty area that Derby are defending. Hoylett drags it back under his studs, sends in a cross way too high. Woeful cross actually from Hoylett, and that goes out for a goal kick to Derby, and a nice build-up goes to waste. Look at Harry Redknapp down here. I think he wants to make a change.
Yeah, well, Cranshaw's got cramp. I think he's holding his hamstring. So, you know, looking at Cranshaw, I think, you know, there's no subs being made yet, but Traore's warming up. So, looking at Cranshaw, he looks like he's struggling.
Well, Armand Traore, French defender, former Arsenal player. And by the way, it is now 31 minutes played in the game. And a very, very nice moment here. Derby fans right around the stadium are on their feet and applauding. And this is all for Colin Bloomfield, who works for BBC Radio Derby. As Hughes here has a shot from outside the penalty area and goes too high. Colin Bloomfield, who's been suffering from melanoma, got bad news last week that it had spread to his brain as well. He is here today at Wembley as a guest of Derby. And the reason they've picked 31 minutes is because he's only 31 years of age. He's a very good broadcaster. He's very popular. I'm sure you'll have had dealings with him in your time at the club, Robbie Savage. And great to see the Derby fans acknowledging him here today.
What a courageous young man. 31 years old. You know, he lost his father recently too. You know, didn't tell him, obviously, of his cancer. You know, I had the pleasure of working with him and commentating on me. You know, we just wish him all the best. But what a fantastic, you know, inspirational young man.
Yeah, well, we do wish Colin Bloomfield all the very best. And here is the change now that Queen's Park Rangers have been forced into just a half an hour into this game. And the former Arsenal and Portsmouth and Juventus as well defender Armand Traore will come on in place of Cranshaw. Now, we know Traore is a left back. He has played in midfield quite a few times for Queen's Park Rangers this season.
Well, if you're Ravel Morrison, really, you're thinking, do you know what? I know, yes, okay, Traore's left-footed, but, you know, Cranshaw's right-footed player on the left side. So, you know, if you're Ravel Morrison, thinking, am I going to get on today? But Traore, what he's got great pace and great energy. And at the minute, that's what QPR are missing.
Yeah, Ravel Morrison, on loan from West Ham. You know, at one stage this season, early in the campaign, he scored one or two eye-catching goals. And there was even talk, you know, good campaign, he could get in the England squad for the World Cup. Would you play Ravel Morrison in a game like this, Robbie?
Yeah, I think he's, at the minute, what's missing from QPR is somebody to get the foot and a bit of magic. And I think that's what the game's missing in general. I think we've seen Will Hughes with a bit of magic in the box. Arguably could have been a penalty. But looking at that QPR team now, you know, it's pedestrian. Hoylett's got a bit of magic. Other than that, you're looking, where's, you know,
Here is Hoylett. Good mazy dribble. Oh, he's got into the penalty area, right-hand side. One touch too many. He had beaten two defenders there. That's when he needed to release the ball. He took one more heavy touch, and Jake Buxton was able to nip in and clear it away.
He's the danger. Now you're on the pitch, now you're joy by an experience. Every time you get the ball, you're thinking, right, Danny Simpson, stay in your right position. Let Hoylett get isolated against Forsyth. Give him the ball as much as you can, because he's the threat, he's the danger.
Simpson plays it forward. Doyle challenges, oh, he's done well there, making a nuisance of himself. Kevin Doyle now loses control of the ball inside the penalty area, but Queen's Park Rangers get it back. Simpson on the right-hand side, they're still midway inside the Derby half. This is Hoylett now, ball glued to his toes as he just treads right along the touchline, and eventually the ball goes out of play and the linesman's flag is raised, and cheers from the Derby fans close by, because that is a throw-in for their team. 0-0.
So you've got Gary O'Neill there, who's been the centre of the park. Hoylett's got the ball, he's running into his space. You know, the way he's performing, Hoylett, let him get on with it, let him attack, leave him the space and knock the ball past Forsyth and get the cross into the box where Austin and Doyle are waiting.
So Derby County 0, Queen's Park Rangers 0. Today we find out who will be the third club going up to the Premier League, along with Leicester and with Burnley. It has been a really good championship this season, actually. I mean, you look at the form that those two clubs, Leicester and Burnley, were able to produce. And then a proper battle. I mean, up to the last few weeks, there was a lot of clubs still in with a chance of getting to these playoffs. But it's come down to these last two. And so far, hardly anything to choose between Derby County and Queen's Park Rangers. And a free kick now to Derby, which they take quickly and short to Hughes, back out to the right hand side. This is George Thorne, who's on loan from West Brom. He's had quite a few loan periods. He was at Watford not so long ago, Portsmouth, Peterborough as well. Now a chance of a shot from Russell. He didn't quite catch it as he wanted to. It was on target, but no power, and that's easily held onto by Rob Green.
Yeah, he's decent when he gets them little pockets of space in between the midfield and the back four. Johnny Russell, he's got a great goal against Nottingham Forest in that 5-0 victory at the iPro Stadium early in the season. And if you give him time and space in them areas, he can, you know, getting a good shot.
Here's Traore, just on as a substitute, tries a snapshot on the edge of the penalty area. Wisdom has defended it well, and Andre Wisdom clears the ball out of play. Took no chances there. That wasn't an area of the pitch to take a risk, and he's put it out for a throw-in. That means Queen's Park Rangers will remain on the attack. Barton plays it forward to Traore. Heavy touch of the ball, but he holds on to it. Now it's played through O'Neill and out to Simpson on the right-hand side. Queen's Park Rangers in the red and black stripes across their chest. Now out to Clint Hill on the left-hand side. And a chance to look up, and he's floated it to the edge of the D. Charlie Austin tries to control on his chest, and it's taken away from him expertly. And that's very well done through midfield as Derby clear away to the halfway line.
Yeah, Thorne looks a promising player. You know, he's got good strength, good size, very comfortable possession there. You know, once the ball in all areas of the pitch, even if he's marked, that's a sign of a good player. Yeah. Getting on the ball again. Doesn't matter if Joey Barnes close to him, give me the ball, he's in. He's the one trying to dictate the play.
It's true what you say about good size. I mean, he's only 21 years of age. You know, if another former Derby player, kind of Tom Huddleston, he's almost got that sort of build. Very strong arms and upper chest as the ball is cleared away by Buxton over the halfway line, but Queen's Park Rangers will regain possession. Scoreless and 5-5 in the Championship playoff final. Champions League final coming from Lisbon later. Oh, Hoylett's away, and another drizzle. A dribble, but a strong challenge from Buxton. Wins the ball off him, and then a tangle between Simpson and Jamie Ward. Sees Ward spill off the pitch. And play will resume with a free kick to Derby just inside their own half. Buxton's made a few important challenges.
Yeah, he's calmed down a bit in the opening 10 or 15 minutes. He was going in for balls he couldn't win there. He just stayed in his position. You know, let Hoylett come at him. Won the ball, come to him, played a nice, easy pass out. And Jake Buxton knows his limitations. He's a fantastic defender. I think he won a player of the year at Derby this year. You know, as I said, 6 or 7 years ago, he's playing in the conference with Burton. So, you know, days like this for people like Jake Buxton are fantastic. He's become a hero at Derby.
This is Derby's fifth playoff campaign. They've only ever won one of them. It was the last one they were in, 2007. They beat West Brom here at Wembley to get their promotion up to the Premier League. And three times they have come through this process and been disappointed. Wisdom and the ball back to Hughes. This is midway inside the Derby half. And once again, Wisdom, once he realised there wasn't a safe pass on, he was happy to just turn and and roll it back to the goalkeeper, Lee Grant.
Very comfortable in possession, Derby. What QPR are doing, they're trying to press them out of the pitch now. They're trying to make them kick it, but you've got to say, you know, they've had, you know, Will Hughes and Hendrick and Thorne are trying to dictate the game now. The three against two, you know, playing triangles, and at the minute, O'Neill and Barton can't get near him.
Yeah, Chris Martin trying to burst into the Queen's Park Rangers penalty area. Nedim Nua, who's no slouch, plenty of pace, got there first and cleared it out for a Derby throw, which has been taken in towards Chris Martin. Gives it back to Craig Forsyth, who's probably had the best Derby chance of the match, that header at the far post that he put just too high. It was a tight angle. A Derby come over the halfway line again with Thorne. Now back to Keo. And he skips away from a challenge of Austin in midfield and plays it to the near touchline and Forsyth. Now a direct ball up to Martin. Needs the support of a quick player. Ward provides that outlet. He's tripped. Tripped by Anua. Free kick to Derby in an attacking position.
Yeah, what they're doing very well, Derby, is Martin is linking up well with Russell and Ward. Coming in from, you know, the touchline, Ward there. They both direct players. They like getting their head down, running direct at the centre, at the fullback or the centre half, and making, committing them and letting him make a challenge. That time it was Ward on Anua, and he's got a great now chance on his right foot, Jamie Ward, to whip the ball into a dangerous area.
Yes, this is 10-12 yards outside the penalty area. It is wide on the left-hand side, and Jamie Ward with the bright yellow boots, short run up, floats it in. Great delivery and a really good save from Rob Green. I'm not sure if any Derby player got a touch on that on the way through. It would have been Ward's goal direct from the free kick had Rob Green not dived down to his left-hand side and just about fingertipped it out for a corner. Big, big chance.
Wonderful save, because just bounced before him as well. He's anticipating nobody's going to get a touch. Great save from Robert Green.
Best chance of the game so far, best save as well. Here comes the corner, Hughes whips it in, good power, but too close to the goalkeeper. And Rob Green, for the second time in 20 seconds, gets a big, big cheer from the Queen's Park Rangers fans.
Yeah, the court. Oh.
He's bowled the ball out, and he's given it away. And Queen's Park Rangers actually quite fortunate there that Ward, having controlled the ball, was then not able to keep it in play, and the throw-in will be QPR's.
The corners from Derby have been very poor. Russell took the first three. And he's been taken off him now, because Will Hughes took that one and he puts it straight in Robert Green's hands. As Phil was saying about set pieces, so important, you know, whatever level you play at. Derby's four corners have been poor because they've changed the corner take, and I'm not surprised they change it again.
That's the voice of Robbie Savage, who is one of our marquee names summarising at the World Cup in Brazil. We've got a few new names as well. Tony Pulis is going to be with us on 5 Live. Neil Lennon, who's just left his job at Celtic. We've got Brad Friedel as well. Here come Derby down the right-hand side. Richard Dunn looks to have things covered on the edge of the box, and he does, and that's good defending. And he puts it out for a throw-in on the right-hand side. But it's going to be really great in Brazil next month, and we'll have all the games live for you here on 5 Live. Throw-in to Derby. Wisdom prepares to take it. Hughes is available on the edge of the box. Gives it short, though, to Ward. Ward then plays a 1-2 back to Wisdom, who is fouling his opponent as he tries to get onto it. That's actually a good wise head by Clint Hill. I think he's won that free kick, and it relieves a lot of pressure for Queen's Park Rangers. 0-0.
You know, I'd be interested to see what Phil thinks, because as a player, you know, when you're on the pitch, you recognise when you're in the ascendancy. So if you're Thorne, or as a midfield player, or Hughes, you're thinking, right, we're on top here, let's go and try and get a goal. We're comfortable at the back, QPR aren't creating as many problems. So if you're Harry Redknapp, you know, and Phil will have a view on it, do you say, listen, let's get to half time, do we change something? Because I wouldn't say they're getting overrun, but they need something to happen for QPR.
Yeah, we'll try and get a comment from Phil Brown on that in just a moment. It's 0-0 here at Wembley on 5 Live, and another free kick has been awarded to Derby. I think, you know, for any listeners just tuning away and joining us, Robbie, Queen's Park Rangers started the best. They are the best 10 minutes. Then yeah. Derby have had a good spell, and now it's sort of back even Stephen again.
Yeah, you know, QPR is starting. Cranchard's gone off. That's a blow, because with the exception of Hoylett, there's nobody there really who can take people on, you know, with a bit of pace or a bit of magic. Austin will get the goals, yes. But they look a team with no real pace in it.
I believe Phil Brown is listening, if you want to make that point to him, Robbie, or Phil, you probably heard, did you?
Connor, I'm thinking the way Robbie's talking, what he's talking about is who's going to make the difference for either side, you know, and sometimes when you've got a blend of a team, it's the system that wins you the game. I think where Derby's concerned, I would disagree with what you said towards the end. I think Derby's in the ascendancy and they don't want half-time. I think they've got young players out there, and they, like Robbie said before the game, they're showing a level of energy that's above QPR at the moment, but it's because of that extra man in midfield. They're getting on the ball, they're passing it with more confidence, and they're the one looking more likely to get the opening goal for me.
Yep, this is Hughes, gets to within 10 yards of the penalty area, but he's tackled, and now the chance of a counter-attack for QPR. Clint Hill releases Traore, running with long strides, into the penalty area, he shoots, but he didn't catch it right, and it goes harmlessly across the face of goal, and out for a goal kick to Derby. But a little reminder of how quick Queen's Park Rangers can be on the counter-attack. That all started on the edge of their own penalty area.
Yeah, but it didn't look like they were going to score. You know, Traore there on his left foot, you know, he's running at Keogh, but...
There's no one with him, is there?
There's nobody with him. Is there any real conviction in his play? You know, on the point I was making to Phil, I agree, that's what we were saying, Derby in the ascendancy, but from QPR's point of view, if you're Harry Redknapp, do you say, right, okay, let's just ride the storm? I wouldn't say they're battering QPR Derby, but as they're outnumbering midfield and they're just playing with much more conviction, much more energy. You know, as the manager of QPR now, do you say, listen, let's get in half-time? At half-time, what do you say?
This is Clint Hill, plays the ball forward towards Kevin Doyle, releases a pass but doesn't pick out a teammate, and Derby regain possession in midfield. And we've now almost played the 45 minutes of the first half. Derby in possession, left-hand side with Forsyth, rolls it in low to the feet of Johnny Russell, former Dundee United player. And once again, Derby lose the ball cheaply in midfield. Just 1 minute to be added on for stoppages. Kevin Doyle makes a storming run here, but great tackle by George Thorne right on the edge of the penalty area to win possession back for Derby. And now they come over the halfway line, and a nice 1-2 is played. And Ward launches the ball too far in front of Chris Martin, and that should be dealt with by Simpson, who puts it out for a Derby throw.
Brilliant. George Thorne being an outstanding player on the pitch for me, and his work rate, his energy, power, strength. You know, what an addition to this squad this season on loan. I think, is he on loan still from West Brom?
Yeah, from West Brom on loan. Yep.
You know, he's been magnificent in there, and basically they're outnumbering QPR in the middle of the park. Barton hasn't got the legs anymore. Yes, he's when he gets the ball, he can dictate play. O'Neill, they've not been in the game, them two, at all. So I'd change it at half-time if I was there to get, you know, get an extra man in there.
It was a great coup to get George Thorne. I mean, he only played his first game for Derby in March. Had been on loan at Watford earlier on in the season. But for Steve McLaren, what a boost it's been to be able to bring a player like that into the team for the closing stages. There is the half-time whistle at Wembley, and one very important save from Rob Green has kept this game at 0-0. There was a bit of penalty controversy as well. Was Will Hughes brought down in the box? I'm sure both teams will be discussing that as they make their way down the tunnel into the dressing room. Derby fans filing past us, giving little waves towards their former captain, Robbie Savage, here. But it's been a very close first half overall.
It has. It's been intriguing. Great atmosphere, pitch, great conditions. QPR started okay, but then Derby have controlled the game in the middle of the park. We said it before, they play with a higher energy. You know, QPR made a few mistakes at the back, but saying that, the quality in the final third from both teams has been poor. That's the, you know, Hoylett on the right hand side here has been the major threat. Thorne's been impressive in the middle of the park, and the one big decision was it wasn't a penalty because the ref didn't give it, but I think some referees might have given that.
Well, how important will that decision be? Time will tell. We've reached half time at Wembley in this one of the most lucrative games in all of sport. It's Derby County 0, Queen's Park Rangers 0.
And that last point you made, Robbie, it is the main point, isn't it? For all the blood and thunder, for all the sliding in, for all the tackles, we've only had two shots on target, both from Derby in that 45 minutes.
Yeah, and that's the disappointing thing with Martin with so many goals and Austin. I think they've been a bit isolated, the pair of them. Doyle's not really been in the game at all, and you've got to say most of the QPR players haven't had, you know, the authority on the game, which they should really. Barton's been, you know, he's not been in the game at all because he can't get near the three. The three against two is difficult, and the quality in the box as well, Chavez, from wide areas, whether it be the fullback or the winger, at times has been exceptionally poor. So, as much as been blood and thunder, sliding tackles, you're right, there's been the lack of quality in there has been exceptionally poor.
Phil Brown, just before we go to the news, from a managerial point of view, when you see your side being outnumbered in midfield, as QPR are, three there for Derby, two for QPR, Are you tempted to shuffle it so you match them up, or do you think you'll get advantages elsewhere?
Well, I'm saying to you and Robbie, it's like welcome to management, because that's the decision that you have to make. It's like before the game started, Robbie was saying, I can't believe Craig Bryson, having played 45 out of 46 games this season and scored as many goals as he has, he's been left on the touchline. But because he's left on the touchline, Derby have got the three in midfield. So it's just that balance of the argument. If the game stays at 0-0, when do you play a hand? Because both managers have got a hand to play, and one is to bring an extra striker on, that's Derby County, and one is to bring an extra midfield player on. And I think where this game's concerned, I think maybe Harry could have done something different instead of just replacing Crankyar with Armand Traore. I thought maybe he could have brought a Ravel Morrison on. Listening to Robbie's comments, absolutely spot on. Where's the difference? Who makes the difference? And the likes of Ravel Morrison will make a difference, but when?
Don't encourage Robbie in the management game. He started me on the bench in a charity game on Monday.
No, we need
to have words about it. At half time here at Wembley, goalless between QPR and Derby. One final place in the Premier League up for grabs. It's a fantastic Saturday of sport. We've already had qualifying for the Monaco Grand Prix. We'll be back there shortly, and we'll talk more about the Heineken Cup final and the PGA at Wentworth and the Champions League final as well. But first, Laura Harms and the BBC News.
On digital, online, smartphone and tablet. This is BBC Five Live.
The family of one of the British sailors who disappeared in the Atlantic say he'll be dearly missed after the wreckage of the yacht was found. Andrew Bridge and three other crew members got into difficulties more than a week ago on their way back from the Caribbean. Six people have been killed in a series of drive-by shootings in the US city of Santa Barbara in California. Eyewitnesses described a black BMW speeding through the streets, spraying bullets at people in a student neighborhood near to a university campus. Police say the suspected gunman was later found dead. George Osborne has said the Conservatives will listen and respond to the concerns of people who voted for UKIP. He was speaking in the wake of the local elections in England, in which the Tories lost more than 230 seats, while UKIP gained 160. President Putin has told foreign journalists that if Prince Charles compared him to Hitler, it's unacceptable and not royal behaviour. He was referring to remarks the prince appeared to make while speaking to a woman in Canada earlier this week. And Pope Francis has called for a peaceful solution to the conflict in Syria. He's begun a 3-day visit to the Middle East.
The best live sport.
Hazard wasn't there, and the header comes in against the bar, and then driven in the end by Turan, the Turkish international. Atletico Madrid celebrates.
Ronaldo has scored a brilliant free kick. He hits it low, below the wall, who all jump in the air, anticipating a high ball, and it's almost like the final insult for the German team.
Next, the Champions League final. Full match commentary. Real Madrid take on Atletico Madrid tonight. 7:45 kickoff. The best live sport on BBC Radio 5 Live.
We're at Wembley for the Championship playoff final. Sandwiched in between us and the Champions League final is the Heineken Cup final. Chris Jones is live at Cardiff talking to the Saracens coach, Mark McCall.
Yes, I've got Mark with me now. Mark, you've just arrived for potentially what is the biggest game in Saracens history?
Yeah, no, it's a big game, of course it is. But the players are in good spirits. They're really confident. We come into the game on some form with a bit of momentum. We know it's going to be a tough challenge today, of course. Toulon are a great side, but we'll give it everything we've got.
Now, you only travelled down from London today, Mark, rather than yesterday. What's the thinking behind that?
That's something we've always done. Our players are used to that. We've done it all season. They spent last night in their beds, and we're fortunate to be able to have done that. But no change for us, and we'll get stuck in today.
How's your captain, Mark? Steve Borthwick took a knock to the chest against Harlequins. Is he match fit? Clearly he's in decent spirits if you named him in the starting 15.
Well, he's match fit because he's played all season. He has got an injury. Everybody knows that. We needed to test him on Thursday and make sure that he was functionally strong enough to do all the things you need to do in a rugby match. And he passed all those tests. And we'll see how he goes today, but we're very confident that he's 100% fit.
And is the thinking, Mark, that an 80% Steve Borthwick, because of the experience, because of the inspiration, he's worth his place, even if he's not quite 100%?
No, we wouldn't have played him today if he hadn't been able to functionally do what you need to do as a second row in a game of this magnitude. And and also equally if there was any vulnerability to his shoulder, which there isn't. So Steve's raring to go and he's in good spirits.
Now, you've been a physical side all season, Mark. This Toulon pack is massive. They've got six huge forwards on the bench as well. How ready are your players for what should be a physical onslaught from Toulon?
No, it will be a physical challenge. Things that we've learned, I suppose, over the last 12 months or so in these big matches is the importance of the breakdown, the importance of field position, the importance of connected pressure, and we've got to get a lot of things right today.
Could be starting a very historic week, Mark.
I'll just get today out of the way first of all.
Best of luck.
Thank you.
There you go, Mark. Mark McCall, Saracens Director Rugby, just about an hour away, less than an hour away until kickoff here in Cardiff.
Thank you very much, Chris. Let's talk to our summariser for tonight's game, Matt Dawson. Evening, Matt.
Hi, Mark.
You wouldn't want to be caught between these two, would you, given how physical it's going to be?
No, it's probably not a decent day for the small players. there aren't many small players left, particularly between these two teams. Yeah, the scrum halves will be avoiding as much confrontation as possible, Chappers, that's for sure.
What kind of prospect are Toulon outside of France?
Well, yeah, good question. Do they travel well? Well, they have when they've wanted to. Obviously, they won the competition last year. That they went to Twickenham, beat Saracens. They won over in Ireland. However, a sneaky little part of me just says that Saracens are set up extremely well for European rugby. They are the underdogs today. Toulon do have all of the big star names. They are a world 15. Never mind. I mean, I've seen comparisons to Galactico. This surpasses Galactico. We are talking world 15 stuff here. Every single position. However, I just think the tenacious attitude of Saracens, the likes of Berger, Brits, the Vulapola brothers, I think they can actually do some damage and get to the big star names of Wilkinson and Gittau.
Well, we'll be back with Matt and Ali Eakin and Ian Robertson later from 5 o'clock for full coverage of the Heineken Cup final. And maybe in this qualification match for next season's European Cup, there was an omen in England against France. Sarah Orchard.
Wasps have upset the apple cart in Paris. They've done the double over Stade Francais to take the last seat at Europe's top table next season, the Rugby Champions Cup. Tries from Tom Vandal and Guy Thompson, the difference between the two sides. It finished here today, Stade Francais 6, London Wasps 20, but on aggregate of the two fixtures added together, London Wasps take that final spot with an overall score of 50 points to 35.
Now on to the F1, and Mercedes' Nico Rosberg qualified fastest for tomorrow's Monaco Grand Prix. After a controversial qualifying session earlier today, he finished ahead of teammate Lewis Hamilton and Daniel Ricciardo of Red Bull. But that may not be the end of the story. Our correspondent James Allen joins me from Monaco. What's the latest then, James?
Very interesting stuff, Chappers. It's Rosberg on his final lap. Went into the Mirabeau corner, which is a downhill right-hander, locked up his brakes and went straight on down an escape road. It looked fairly innocuous, except that behind him on the racetrack was his teammate Lewis Hamilton, who was 2.5 tenths of a second up on Rosberg at that point. Now, because Rosberg made the mistake, the yellow flags came out, so everybody had to back off. It ruined Hamilton's lap, and people are comparing it to what Michael Schumacher did here back in 2006, where he deliberately crashed his car in the final corner into the barriers to stop Mark Webber and Fernando Alonso on that occasion from improving their lap. So there are some parallels. The big question is, did Rosberg do it on purpose? I put the question directly to him. He said, of course not, I would never do a thing like that. But Hamilton's body language in the press conference immediately after the session, and ever since in all his confrontations and dealings with the media, very much suggests that he thinks his teammate did do it on purpose. Hamilton was going to beat him, he said, by over 3 tenths of a second. And Hamilton's playing a psychological game here. He's going to try and turn this to his advantage. The stewards, meanwhile, have said that they would like to take a closer look at it. And they've summoned the Mercedes team and Nico Rosberg to appear before them at 5:15, which is in 15 minutes from now. And they have all the camera angles and tools, and they have all the data from the car that you could possibly ever want to make an informed decision on whether they think that Rosberg did this on purpose. If they feel that he did, the precedent is set by Schumacher back in 2006, he would get moved to the back of the grid.
Well, let's hear from the Mercedes drivers, then we'll start with Rosberg.
No, of course, I need to apologize for having ruined his lap, but yeah, that's the way it is.
Are you even more like Senna and Prost now, with Nico just pulling that into you to screw you over?
Essentially.
How does it feel, though? Because you two, you know, you've come into this and everybody here has been hyping it up. And now it's potentially become a reality and a problem that you guys are going to have to sit down and sort out.
I don't know if Senna and Prost sat down and talked it out. So I quite like the way Senna dealt with it. So I'm going to take a page out of his book.
Do you think you'll have to go and have a discussion now with the bosses and with Lewis and just talk through what happened? Or you feel that there's nothing to talk through?
Well, no. We can, of course, if they ask for it, we can review it. But there's nothing to talk through, and it will be pretty obvious, anyways.
That's both Mercedes drivers, and if that story develops, we will bring you the latest here on 5 Live Sport. Let's get the latest from Wentworth, the PGA Championship, from Ian Carter.
Irishman Shane Lowry out in front with par golf, where one bogey and one birdie so far in six holes to remain at 10 under par. He's two clear of Thomas Akin of South Africa, who's just holed his second shot at the long par 4 ninth to go to the turn in 31. And also at 8 under par is Luke Donald, who had an eagle 3 at the par 5 fourth. Thomas Bjorn also at 8 under par, having just picked up a birdie at the 6th. As for Rory McIlroy, he's back where he started at 5 under par. That despite a double bogey at the 1st, he has picked up birdies at the 4th. And now the 7th, so at 5 under, he is 5 behind.
Elsewhere today, the John Gosden-trained Kingman, ridden by James Doyle, won the Irish 2000 Guineas at the Curragh. The colt, narrowly beaten the Newmarket Guineas 3 weeks ago, beat Shifting Power by 5 lengths to give Doyle his first success in a classic race. Heather Watson's into the main draw of the French Open tennis. The British number 2 will play Barbora Zalavova-Strikova in the first round. In the men's draw, James Ward will meet last year's quarter-finalist Tommy Robredo. Snooker's world number 13, Ali Carter, has been diagnosed with a form of lung cancer. Carter, who is 34, overcame testicular cancer last year. And David Weir has broken the world record for a wheelchair road mile in London. His time of 3 minutes and 7 seconds beat his previous time by 2 seconds. Derby already out here at Wembley for the second half of the playoff final. Goalless at half-time against QPR. Juliet Farrington is down in the tunnel.
Yeah, the alarms have just gone off for the second half. As you say, Derby out first. The match officials, though, waiting for Queen's Park Rangers as they make their way back onto the pitch for the second half. The Derby and QPR substitutes during half-time going through their warm-up. The groundsman here at Wembley forking the pitch after that torrential rain. I had a little word with Sean Wright Phillips as well. He thought that QPR was suffering with a few nerves in the first half, but feels that the second half will be theirs. Interestingly, though, Steve McLaren walked down with about a minute to go of normal time remaining. He usually sits in the stand during the first half and at the start of the second, so he wasn't in the dugout. Harry at half-time looked concerned, perhaps, walked down the tunnel with his hands in pockets, looking down to the floor. And Colin Bloomfield, who we had that minute's applause for, in support of Colin on 31 minutes, with his battle against cancer from the Derby fans, he's tweeted he's genuinely overwhelmed by the response of that, and now he's looking forward to a Derby win. Will it be Derby, or will it be Queen's Park Rangers?
Find out with Phil Brown, Robbie Savage and Conor McNamara.
Thanks very much, Mark. So about to get back underway, and what a transformation in conditions from the start of the game an hour ago. We've now got sunshine beaming down on the pitch at Wembley after almost biblical rain when the teams came out for the anthem earlier on. So we're back underway. Queen's Park Rangers in the red and dark hoops, playing from right to left as we look down. Derby in their traditional white shirts with the dark shorts. And it's Armand Traore who came on as a first-half substitute in place of Nico Cranchar, who had picked up a knock around the half-hour mark. And he gives it back to Joey Barton, who attempted a very ambitious ball out to the right wing. But it's not a good execution by Barton. And that goes out for a goal kick to Derby away to our left-hand side. What will both managers have been thinking? Who would have been the most pleased manager, do you think, Robbie Savage, during the half-time break in the dressing room?
Oh, Steve McLaren, no doubt. I think Harry Redknapp was in, you know, enforced change. Cranchar coming off for Traore. But that's when Derby taken over, really, because what Cranchar was doing, Cranchar was coming into the midfield to make a 3v3, really. Since he's gone off, Traore stayed wide, so...
That's Hughes, nice ball on the left-hand side, yeah. And then the cross comes in a little bit too high and floats across the penalty area. Not the first time we've seen that happen today.
Again, you know, good build-up play, balls into the box, no runners, Martin's outside the box, poor quality in the final third. But so I think, going back to your question, I think Derby took over because Cranchard wasn't coming to make the three in there. Troy staying wide, so that's when the three of Derby overrun the two of QPR in midfield there. So, you know, I'd be surprised if I don't see an introduction of another midfielder soon for QPR.
Yeah, Steve McLaren looking to exercise a few ghosts this afternoon. He's back here at Wembley, first time he's brought a team to this stadium since he was England manager, and that incident in the rain against Croatia and his umbrella famously. And of course, he's not been a manager in the Premier League since leaving Middlesbrough to take the England job. I think there's two little things on his bucket list that he would like to get off his back this evening if he could get this victory and return to being a Premier League manager. Remember, at the start of this season, he was a coach working for Harry Redknapp at Queen's Park Rangers. Derby have possession at the back, and it's Keogh who just swivels and clears the ball away high up towards Martin, challenged by Richard Dunn, who's had a good handle on things. I mean, Richard Dunn was the defender in the penalty appeal in the first half. And apart from that, it's been very solid and everything under control from Richard Dunn. And he did get away with that challenge in the box, which had Derby screaming for a spot kick. Ball's gone out of play on the far side. Throw in for Derby. Total transformation in the weather. They're now peeling off their coats away to our left and they're sunbathing, the Queen's Park Rangers fans. Derby fans in shade. Here's Hughes, 10 yards outside the penalty area. Nice touch out to Ward on the left-hand side, but he can't deliver the cross. Well defended, that's out for a throw.
You know, what a fantastic opportunity for both teams here. QPR attacking their fans, Derby attacking their fans. Imagine the score and the winning for your own fans at Wembley for one of these players. They're going to become a hero.
Well, they had a game with some schoolboys down on the pitch before kick-off, and some young boy scored a goal, and you could see his parents jumping as if they'd won the lottery. They'll be telling people forever about how he scored his goal at Wembley, the young lad who was probably about 8 years of age. Here comes another chance to cross. Martin's in around the edge of the six-yard box. Well dealt with by Richard Dunn. Just stood his ground on the edge of the six-yard box, and Queen's Park Rangers are able to clear away. Long ball from Simpson up into the sunlight part of the pitch as Doyle controls the ball down for Traore. Queen's Park Rangers holding on to possession, and now they've got a free kick anyway for a foul on Joey Barton by Hughes.
You know, looking at that first half as well, you know, QB had 10 minute spell. I think Derby had 66-67% possession as well, and at the minute QPR look like they have no ideas at all. They look very pedestrian in their play, and you've got to say, you know, Derby, you know, I'm impartial, and I know you're the captain, Derby, but you call it how it is, and QPR have not been on it so far.
Yeah. Steve McLaren has gone to take a seat in the stand to watch this opening phase of the second half. Richard Dunn on the ball for Queen's Park Rangers. Neil Turner give it back to the goalkeeper. So Rob Green in goal for Queen's Park Rangers. Back four of Danny Simpson, Neda Manua, Richard Dunn and Clint Hill, the captain. They've got O'Neill and Barton in the middle of midfield. Hoylett and Traore on the flanks. Doyle and Austin, the two up front. And a nice header back by O'Neill to Hill. Plays it forward for Queen's Park Rangers. Headed away by Keogh for Derby. Barton gets a header inside the centre circle. Hoylett with a good ball out into space on the right-hand side for Danny Simpson. Gives it back to Hoylett again. They need to get him on the ball. I mean, we were very impressed with Junior Hoylett in the opening stages here as Kevin Doyle flicks on a header and Queen's Park Rangers are going to lose the ball. The impressive George Thorne, who was one of the best players on the pitch in the first half, he takes the ball out of the fence and he wins a throw-in for Derby on the far side.
But look at that there. The ball's played up to Doyle, wins the header, but Joey Barton and Gary O'Neill, so, you know, miles behind the play because they're scared about the break from the three in midfield, so they're holding back. That's when you need your second centre forward, Austin, to read the flick on, and they're just too far apart, the centre forwards with Queen's Park Rangers.
Very nice chest down by Martin, and there's a ball for Johnny Russell to chase, and his pressure put Richard Dunn in a tricky position there, and the Irish defender had no choice but to put it out for a corner. Derby's first corner of the second half. It is 0-0 on 5 live in the Skybet Championship playoff final.
Yeah, you're looking at the minute now. Derby started the second half where they left off the first, full of energy, closing every ball down, making the QPR defenders make mistakes, and that's a mistake from Dunn there, putting the ball out for a corner for Derby.
Derby fans can sense something here. Most of them up on their feet as the ball is swung in for the corner. Dunn underneath it for Queen's Park Rangers. Good defensive header. And then a bit of a miscued second header by Simpson. He was trying to clear it out of the box. It came off the wrong side of his head. It's gone out for another corner to Derby.
Yeah, better delivery that time from Jamie Waugh from that right-hand side. Whipped in. Good header from Dunn. But Simpson there, the spin on the ball must have took it, yeah, you know, out. for a corner.
Will Hughes, who only turned 19 in April, places the ball for the corner. He looks even younger than 19. Great ball swung in, headed up into the air by Clint Till. Queen's Park Rangers haven't got it away. It'll be Hughes again on the right-hand side. Great first touch to ride a challenge, and then he wins another corner, plays the ball off in Nua. And this young man, Will Hughes, he's got a lot of good press this season, and he is impressing here on the big stage.
Yeah, better ball into the box again, but Clint Till and Dunn's last two headers have been fantastic. You know, two big, strong, powerful centre-halves, good, you know, good defensive headers there, but better quality again. That was that time from Will Hughes.
That's the voice of Robbie Savage watching this game with us here at Wembley. Will Hughes, who scored in the second leg of Derby's semi-final win against Brighton, places the ball for the corner. The bright orange boots, adulation for the Derby fans close to him. Here comes the delivery, left footed. Goalkeeper surely was being impeded there, and he wasn't needed in the end as the ball is cleared away. Well, certainly away from the immediate danger of the 6-yard box. Hughes gets it back again, floats one in. Thorne jumps. There's a miscued clearance from Hill, goes straight up into the air. Hughes beaten to a header, but Derby have still got possession on the right hand side. And a little bit of space here now for Craig Forsyth to get his head up to play it into the penalty area. Richard Dunn, well positioned, clears it away.
QPR solid defending, good defending all over the place. So Derby massively in the ascendancy here, just need a bit of quality in that final third.
Oh, Andre Wisdom stretches and he won't control, and the ball goes out of play, and that takes momentum, just sucks the life out of the Derby attack.
But great defending from Dunn, Hill, Onua there, stayed in their positions, you know, didn't panic, good strong headers out and defended exceptionally well.
Well, Queen's Park Rangers' last promotion to the Premier League was in 2011. Can Harry Redknapp lead the club from Loftus Road back up into the Premier League? He's having a word here with Bobby Zamora, who has scored goals in Championship playoff finals in the past. Zamora's taking off his bib and his tracksuit. I think he's going to be coming on shortly for Queen's Park Rangers.
You'd have got to think it'd be Doyle. Doyle's not contributed at all to this game. He's been on the fringes, as have most QPR players. But Bobby Zamora, I thought he might have gone with him from the start because the impact he had when he came on against Wigan in that second leg, he was very, very good. So, you know, Bobby Zamora occupied the two centre-halves better than Doyle with Austin.
He's only scored 3 goals this season, Bobby Zamora. He's had his injury problems, of course. The last one he got came in April, that 5-2 win against Nottingham Forest. But Bobby Zamora is going to come on here as a substitute early in the second half at Wembley. Rob Green clears the ball away. He was under pressure from Will Hughes, and that has gone straight out of play, and Derby will win a throw-in. And it's that atmosphere, this game, which means so much, which has been so close since kickoff. Even when the teams win a throw-in, the fans are on their feet and cheering. You'll take anything you can get when the stakes are this high.
Yeah, and to be fair, both sets of fans have been fantastic. Yeah. But there's not been many real, well, I don't think there's been one clear-cut chance yet. We've had a ward-free kick, which Rob Green saved well. But other than that, no chances at all.
Corner to Derby, another one. And they are beginning to pile on the pressure. And Anua, who put the ball out, just takes a position here on the edge of the 6-yard box. Dunn is in there as well. But Derby is sending up all of their big men. Thorne is a real target in there. Ball played towards the back post, and it's a free header for Charlie Austin to clear it away. Now, chance of a counter-attack for Queen's Park Rangers. Junior Hoyland, 10 yards inside his own half, plays it forward for Traore, who cannot control, and Wisdom will mop it up for Derby and play back to the goalkeeper, Lee Grant.
I think it's the right time to bring Zamora on. I think QPR look void of ideas, especially in the final third. And to be fair, so did Derby. Yes, they're getting a few corners, Derby, but in terms of real, real quality, that's what the game's missed. So I think it's a fantastic decision from Harry to bring on Bobby Zamora, because what he has got, what he lacks in pace, he's got quality. You know, yep. When the ball goes up to him, he can bring people into play, but you need runners from midfield, and I don't think Joey Barton or Gary O'Neill are going to do that.
We've had it confirmed for the touch on. It will be Kevin Doyle coming off to allow Bobby Zamora to come on. Queen's Park Rangers have possession. Hoyland on the halfway line, right hand side. Traore in front of him, can't get a touch of the ball. And you'd sort of say that about the Queen's Park Rangers midfield at the moment. Their defence are doing sterling work clearing it away. The ball is not being held onto in midfield. There's no ball retention from Harry Redknapp's team at the moment. 0-0 on 5 live. A cauldron of noise at Wembley. as Richard Dunn left-footed sends it away, and there's a miscue at the back, and this could be a chance for Charlie Austin. Well dealt with by Jake Buxton. Picking up the pieces now is Doyle, supported by Traore. Brilliant ball, chance for Austin, and he's put it wide. Right-footed shot. He tried to swivel and shoot in one motion. An instep shot which goes 2 feet wide of the target. That is definitely the best chance of the second half.
That was the chance. Traore down the left-hand side. What Austin done, he just stayed out near the penalty spot. He pulled it back. The ball's come across him. He opened his body up to try and side foot it in the far corner. Difficult technique that, and he didn't quite get it right. But that's the first real opportunity of the game. As a substitution made, Doyle off, Zamora on.
Charlie Austin has been waiting all game for that opportunity to fall to him, and he scuffed the shot. Derby County nil, Queen's Park Rangers nil. That's probably QPR's best chance of the game.
That's the best chance of the game. Yeah. Never mind QPR derbies, that is the best chance. And you think Charlie Austin, you know, his technique was all wrong. It's a difficult technique that, when the ball comes across, you've got to open your right foot and then place it in the far corner.
And he is the man that Queen's Park Rangers fans would have wanted that chance to fall to. 20 goals this season despite a lengthy injury layoff. Queen's Park Rangers on the ball again. Gary O'Neill, good run. He's got away from Johnny Russell. Releases the ball now further up the pitch to Austin. Hill has come up from left back to support the midfield. This is Joey Barton in a more anchor role. And then Hill turns and gives it back to Richard Dunn. And it's, you've got to say, an organised shape that Derby County have at the moment. Narrowing down the options, and the ball is given away in midfield. Ward comes over the halfway line. Strong challenge from Barton to win the ball. Then there's a slip by Hoylett. Recovers his composure. Recovers the ball. Gives it in low. Cross the edge of the area. Austin's shot. Did it take a deflection? Referee says no. Goal kick to Derby. But it is building up. It's simmering away nicely now. Phil Brown is sitting just away to our right-hand side. I think already, Phil, it's a better game in the second half than it was in the first.
It's a cracking game, and chances are going to, you know, the longer the game goes on, chances are going to come for sure. And I think it's a great move by Harry. It was only a matter of time before he had to make the move, but they certainly need to get the ball into the opposition's half with a little bit more quality and a little bit more quality hold up play, and that's what you're going to get from Bobby Zamora. But you know, the first half I think belonged to Derby, certainly in terms of territory and possession, and they've started the second half in exactly the same way. You know, unforced errors, given corners away, set pieces will play a part. They've had four. Oh, chance.
Here's a chance. Oh. And taken down on the edge of the penalty area. Gary O'Neill has got to be in trouble here. Well, he's fallen in the penalty area, Russell. The challenge was outside the box. And a card has been shown, is it? No, well, there are several players making all sorts of protests here. Lee Mason is going to come across and speak to his assistant. This could be a pivotal moment in the game. I don't think it's a penalty, well be a red card.
It's outside the box, but is it a clear goal-scoring opportunity?
He's about to shoot.
I think it's a clear goal-scoring opportunity, therefore you have to send him off.
Here we go, big moment. He's reaching for his pocket, he's off! It's a red card! Early in the second half, and Queen's Park Rangers, in the biggest game of their season, will now have to play with just 10 men. Gary O'Neill, a professional foul, really. He knew Johnny Russell was going to be in to have a shot at goal. He lunged out, took the feet out from underneath him. I think it's the right decision. Robbie Savage.
Yeah, I think so too. And what it is, Clinton Hill was he coming round quick enough? I don't think he was. I think the referee's got that spot on. It was a last minute lunge from Johnny Russell. You know, Johnny Russell's two footed. Yes, he's predominantly left footed, but it's on his right foot. He's going to get a clean strike at a goal. It's a clear goal scoring opportunity. Therefore, the referee's made the right decision.
Well, what an advantage this could be for Derby County now. 11 men against 10 at Wembley. And Queen's Park Rangers have also got this free kick right on the edge of the penalty area to defend. Ward is standing over it. So too the man who won the free kick, Johnny Russell. He must have thought he was in there to score before the legs were taken out from underneath him. Look at Andre Wisdom here. He's in the penalty area. There's no one picking him up. It'll be a shot from Ward through the pedal, through the wall, but it hits Richard Dunn behind it. And that goes out for a corner to Derby, whose fans are just beginning to sense that this final is turning in their favour. It's still 0-0, though.
What a chance now for Derby to get to the Premier League. 10 men, better possession, more possession.
Corner from Will Hughes, sends it in, left footed, came off the shoulder I think of Buxton in there. Queen's Park Rangers still haven't cleared it away, but they will win a free kick for a foul on Zamora. Let's go down to the tunnel. Juliet Farrington is close to boat managers.
Yeah, boat managers, as Harry Redknapp is calling another of his substitutes towards the technical area. He's taking his green bib off. But interestingly, Gary O'Neill, as he walked off the pitch following that red card, he got to the entrance of the tunnel to make that long walk down, put his hands on his knees in disbelief, probably frustrated with himself for what he did. But then as he was walking down the tunnel towards the players' area through the doors, he had his head in his hand, so disappointed with the reaction and probably so disappointed with that red card here in that playoff final. But the Derby dugout in front of me, sitting behind the team of players, they were very happy with that decision made by the referee Lee Mason.
Thanks very much, Juliet. Strong run there by Jeff Hendrick down the left-hand side, but eventually both he and the ball are bundled out of play and Queen's Park Rangers regain possession. So Harry Redknapp preparing to make another substitution here. Phil Brown, give us another opinion. What you know, did the officials get that right with the red card?
You've got to take your hat off to the officials, to tell you the truth. Lee Mason's bought himself time, you know, and that is a pressure cooker situation. You ask any top referee and he does not want to make them big decisions in playoff finals. No penalties, sending offs, etc, etc. He's bought himself time and he's made the right decision, to be fair. It was last man, no doubt about it. It was a clear goal scoring opportunity. The one thing I'll say about Gary O'Neill is he shouldn't have done it, because you've still got the goalkeeper to beat, you know, and you've always got that in you as a trump card. You've got to beat the goalkeeper, so to stay 11-11 would have been a better decision.
Yeah. No, I think we're in agreement there, Phil, and I think credit where credit is due to Lee Mason and his assistants, and I think they've got that right. Down in the technical area, Carl Henry is preparing to come on for Queen's Park Rangers. What this means, Robbie Savage, is that's a third change for QPR. We won't see Ravel Morrison in this game.
Well, the big decision Harry's got now is, do I take a centre forward off?
Yeah.
You know, what do I do? You know, it's Charlie Austin's gone back into the middle of the park. You know, so he's got left Zamora for on his own. Austin now playing as a centre midfielder. You know, this is where a manager, as Phil will tell you, earns his money. Henry coming on, who do I take off?
It's a huge decision.
Because if it goes for extra time, we've got one centre forward on the pitch.
Yeah.
You know, Derby having all the possession, they're going to get more possession now. Do you go for set pieces? Big decision.
0-0 on 5 Live between Derby County and Queen's Park Rangers, and boy, is it tense.
Because you've just put Zamora on, you know, if you take a centre forward off, you know, you take Charlie Austin off, or do you take Zamora off? You can't take Joey Barton off. You know, do you take Triori off? It's a big decision coming off Harry Redknapp.
Well, you would
think, taking his time over it.
You know, Charlie Austin, who has scored 20 goals this season, far and away. I think the next highest scorer is Ravel Morrison, and he's got 6. Here's a chance. Russell again, edge of the tee. Much better tackle this time. Neda Manua winning the ball and getting it back to the safety of the goalkeeper, Rob Green. Good defending.
What Derby have done great this half, both wingers, Ward and Russell, they're making them diagonal runs, and what the midfielder's doing, he's looking up, no pressure on the ball, he's just trying to slide it into their path, you know, and Russell's making some fantastic runs. He looks a real threat, Russell.
Now, you must have played in teams, Robbie, where you go down to 10 men, you've got a long way to go. I mean, does it galvanise the team? Does it give you that siege mentality?
It does.
Is that a myth or is that a real thing?
It's a real thing, you know, and Phil would have played against teams who have gone down 10 men. It's, you know, what you've got to do with a team with 11 playing against a 10, you've got to be patient. You've got to pick your opportunities, get the ball wide, keep switching play and wait for the chance to open up. Don't force it, you know, don't panic. Yeah. You know, if you're the 10 men, stay in your two banks of four or four or five, whatever you're going to do, and just be strong, resolute. And sometimes it's harder to play against 10 men.
Ward down the left-hand side for Derby. Swings it across. Barton didn't deal with it the first time and he was put under pressure by Johnny Russell. And then Joey Barton was able to clear it away. So we're being told that the player coming off for Queen's Park Rangers is Junior Hoylett. It was probably their best player in the first half.
That's a bizarre decision because, no disrespect, Traore, you know, he's come on the pitch. I think Hoylett's been their most likely threat down that right-hand side. Yeah, sub, Traore. You know, I'd rather leave Hoylett on, to be honest. I don't know what Phil would think.
Hendrick crosses from the left-hand side for Derby and it's well held onto by Rob Green. So Carl Henry, former Stoke and Wolves midfielder, is still waiting to come on because the ball hasn't gone dead yet. Phil Brown, the Southend boss, what do you make of this change? Bringing off Junior Hoylett, bringing on Carl Henry with 10 men.
I think where Harry's concerned, he's looking at one chance. He's in one chance saloon, really. If it goes to extra time down to 10 men, he'll probably lose it with the legs. We've already made reference, if it was 11-11, Derby have got bags and bags of energy in the team. So he's looking likely he wants to go to maybe a 4-3-2. And that maybe will solve the problem in midfield, because they've been overrun in midfield. They'll go back to three against three in midfield, and you'll still have your two strikers.
Do you know what? Sorry to interrupt, Phil. They've actually had a change of mind. There's been a flurry of activity down in the technical area. It was supposed to be Junior Hoylett coming off.
Yeah.
Harry Redknapp has reconsidered, and it's actually going to be the captain, the left back, Clint Hill, who's coming off, and Carl Henry coming on in his place, Phil.
I think what he's done is put Armand Traore, who can play left back.
Well, that does make sense, doesn't it? Yeah,
he plays the pace. Now, looking likely, it's going to be 4-4-1. Just leave the one up top, and like Charlie Austin will play on the left-hand side in front of Traore, by the looks of it. And he'll play and he'll wait for his moment, because you'll still have three in midfield eventually if he shuffles the pack slightly. And he needs to get support to Bobby Zamora, and he needs to, like what Robbie said, he probably needs to play for a set piece. That might be his only opportunity, if not counter-attacking football, because Derby's going to have the majority of possession for the rest of the game.
Thanks very much, Phil. It's all changed down there. Two substitutions as well for Derby County. They're bringing on Simon Dawkins, former Tottenham player. He's attack-minded. And they're also bringing on Craig Bryson. Now, Robbie Savage, this is the man you've wanted to see on the pitch. Tell the listeners why.
Well, because he's got 16 goals from midfield. He makes fantastic runs. He's got great energy. Been Derby's player of the year. You know, he's going to have a big impact. But I'm surprised Johnny Russell's gone off, actually, for Dawkins. Willie Hughes has gone off for Bryson. You know, you can see that change happening. But Johnny Russell, in a time of a game, looked disappointed when he was going off. He was making some fantastic runs. He got the foul for the sending off of O'Neill. So I'm surprised by that substitution. And what's happened is Dawkins has gone to the left, and Jamie Ward's come over to this right-hand side now. So with Bryson just going like for like with Will Hughes, but... surprised Russell's gone off, actually.
Yeah, so just to confirm, with the red card shown for Queen's Park Rangers to Gary O'Neill, they have brought Carl Henry on in midfield. They've taken off the left back Clint Hill. Traore has dropped to left back. Dawkins has come on up front for Derby in place of Russell, as the ball is played into the penalty area and Richard Dunn heads away again. And Craig Bryson has come on in midfield in place of young Will Hughes. Derby are on the ball. Hendrick on the right, and he's challenged by Traore. The ball goes out of play for a Derby throw-in.
And what you get when you've got the 4-4-1, you've got the two banks of four rigid in their formation. You have Traore with Austin ahead of him. You know, you'd be close together, no spaces in between.
Great ball, chance now in the penalty area. Bryce has just shot, shoots on target, saved out for a corner by Rob Green. It was a low shot, it was trying to catch the goalkeeper out at his near post. Rob Green alerts to it and puts it out for a corner. What a chance.
That's what Bryson does. He makes great runs into great areas, one touch out of his feet. You know, Rob Green was lucky, really. Just bobbled in front of him, got it away for a corner.
Midway through the second half at Wembley, it's still 0-0. Corner is whipped in, right-footed by Ward. Cleared away by Queen's Park Rangers. Wisdom will pick it up in a defensive location for Derby. Gives it back out to Ward. Early pass for Bryson. Does well to get there. Martin shot saved again. Saved by Rob Green and out for a corner. And the former England goalkeeper has suddenly become the busiest man on the pitch. And Derby making the extra man count at the moment.
Yeah, they're battering QPR now. It looks like it's just a matter of time, but what QPR are doing, they're defending well. Rob Green's having a blinder.
This is Five Live from the BBC. Ward's corner, headed away again. They've done well airily, Queen's Park Rangers. Now the ball is shifted by Thorne to his right-hand side to Bryson. Plays a 1-2 on the edge of the penalty area. He's been brilliant since coming on. Now, good footwork on the right-hand side from Ward. Gets to a crossing position, hangs in the cross, but it's headed away off target, and it remains Derby County 0, Queen's Park Rangers 0. But the Derby fans are the ones who are enjoying this at the moment. Their team very definitely on top, and with a man advantage as well.
Well, what they're doing, I know there's not much experience out there in big games for Derby players. What they're doing, they're keeping the ball well. And as Phil will tell you, 11 against 10, we've both been in teams that have played against the 10 men. You have to be patient, you have to keep the ball, you have to get the ball wide, keep transferring it, and wait for that little bit of magic, that little killer pass. And that they're doing that exceptionally well at the minute. And but QPR, two banks of four, stay tight, stay compact, and just, you know, try and get a set piece or one breakaway.
A place in the Premier League next season at stake. And it's 0-0 between Derby and Queen's Park Rangers. And Ward is into the penalty area again. And Traore tries to hold him off. And was that a back pass? As the goalkeeper, Green, came out and picked up the ball. Traore was sort of shielding it. And he must not have had a pass on it, because the official surely would have blown up. It comes off his knee. Okay, you wouldn't say that was an intentional back pass. I think the officials have got that right.
Yeah, I think they have, yeah. I think he was shielding the ball. Good strength from Traore, but it's all Derby now. And it's all Derby. And what you've got to feel for the QPR players, Derby are much younger, much fresher, fitter.
Steve McLaren's come back down to the technical area, having watched from the stand since half-time. Another cross on the left-hand side is held onto by Rob Green. If anything, Derby look more dangerous when they come in low to the penalties. High balls are being easily dealt with by QPR.
The quality from out wide, to be fair, has been really poor. But sure. You know, it's such a funny old game, Connor. You know, one chance for QPR. You know, that chance going back before the game, we said about Charlie Austin's chance for Swindon, which he missed. And I think Chappers related to it. Going back to early in the game when there was 11v11, what a chance for Charlie Austin. Yeah, penalty yeah. Spot, opened his body up, you know, didn't hit the target, the best chance of the game. So will he really regret that? 11v11, it was the best chance of the game.
Yeah, he's already got regrets for missing sitters in big games at Wembley. Will Charlie Austin get to rue that one? Queen's Park Rangers have possession, playing with 10 men here, 0-0 on 5 live. Gary O'Neill, who was sent off, has just come back out wearing a tracksuit top and taken a seat amongst the substitutes on the bench. All three changes have now been made by Harry Redknapp. And remember, if it stays 0-0 or on level terms through 90 minutes, we will have extra time, penalties if necessary, to decide who goes through to the Premier League next season, who joins Leicester and Burnley in getting promoted. What a penalty shootout that will be to win promotion to the Premier League. And as we mentioned before, for Derby County, it's estimated the value of winning this game, this one game, is £140 million. Those are the stakes. As Wisdom has gone probably as far advanced forward as he's been in the second half, trying to get in around the back of Traore. Traore stands his ground again, and he's done well, the former Arsenal man, and that goes out for a goal kick. Robbie Savage.
You know what? You know, the thing about getting sent off as well for Gary O'Neill, he's obviously massively disappointed, but, you know, as he goes out and tries to go on the bench and sit there and watch his team, he's not allowed to sit on the bench. So somebody then grabs him and says, sorry, mate, you can't see, you've been sent off. So, you know, it's punishment enough to get sent off, but you know, yeah, you should be allowed to sit on your bench and watch your teammates, you know. So,
well, I think particularly at Wembley, where the bench sort of consists of about four or five rows of seats, it's not like the old dugouts, is it? Yeah,
but playing against the 10, you know, if you're the Derby back four, you've got to stay switched on, you won't be getting many balls up against you. The majority of player being QPR's half, you have to be switched on, because the QPR probably will get a chance in this game.
Yeah. Bright sunshine now at Wembley. It was teeming in rain in the first half. Derby are on the attack using their extra man advantage. Good ball by Hendrick into the penalty area, and Dawkins tried to control. The linesman's flag is raised. Shot comes in anyway from Ward. I don't think that would have counted, and an offside decision had been given in Queen's Park Rangers' favour. So Simon Dawkins, interesting CV. He's a former Tottenham player. He was on loan at Aston Villa last season. Before that, he spent 2 years in America. He played with the San Jose Earthquakes in the MLS. He's only 26 years of age, and he had a loan move, scored a few goals before Christmas, then made the move permanent to Derby, and he's only scored once since making that permanent signing. It came against Leeds earlier on this month, but Dawkins is up, part of a three-pronged attack for Derby in this second half. On the ball at the moment, the impressive George Thorne lays the ball to the right-hand side to Andre Wisdom, on loan from Liverpool. Just cuts back, plays an easy pass in field to his captain, Richard Keogh, former Coventry defender. This is Jake Buxton now coming over the halfway line. Queen's Park Rangers being pulled and dragged across the pitch now. That's a really good ball to the edge of the area. Bryson helps it on. He might get in again. Bryson right to the byline. Now tees it up. Dawkins, what a chance. Brilliant save, Robert Green. Another chance, came off his own player and goes out for a goal kick. It hit Martin on the way through. What an opportunity. There was three chances in there, really. And it's all that man. It's Craig Bryson. Since coming on, he has transformed Derby County.
Yeah, he was great. Cool. But again, another good save from Robert Green, who's keeping QPR in this game. And it fell to Jamie Ward, the rebound. It's actually hit his old man Martin and gone out for a goal kick. But they're doing it well, Derby, against the 10. They're getting the ball wide. They're not panicking. They're not launching high balls. They're being patient. Decent ball across the ball. Bryson's made a difference, as you said before the game. Them runs, he makes intelligent runs. He doesn't run into needless areas. He times his run well. You know, good little link-up play. You've got to say, it's just a matter of time before Derby get the ball in the back of there. But, you know, QPR defending exceptionally well, to be fair to him.
Well, you used the word patience, Robbie, just after the red card. The Derby have to be patient. There is an expectancy on them now, with Queen's Park Rangers down to 10 men, that they should go on and win this game. But they've got to stick to the original plan. Play their own game. Don't change that. They've got possession, crossing position on the left, and it goes out for a throw.
They'll never have a better chance. You know, they're playing against 10 men. They were the better team in the first half. They had more possession. They got looked like they got fresher legs. They got more pace. Yeah. So if you're looking at all that, you know, Derby should go on to win this game. But as we've seen, you know, football's not that easy, kind of.
Yeah, Queen's Park Rangers, who are playing with Bobby Zamora up front and pretty much everyone back in defence at the moment, as the ball goes out for another Derby throw. Wisdom takes it quickly, throws the ball back to Jamie Ward, scoops it into the penalty area. No one picking up Dawkins. He can head it down, and then it's dribbling out towards a corner anyway, so they allow it go out of play. Hendrick, knowing it'll be a corner, now trots into the centre. And a corner to Derby on the right-hand side, Jamie Ward preparing to take. So far, Queen's Park Rangers has defended these high balls very well. Let's see what Ward could produce. Short run-up, right-footed cross, comes in across the edge of the six-yard box. Traore underneath it, heads it high up into the air. Derby get it back again. They remain on the attack. This is Ward on the right-hand side, on his left boot, less favoured, sends it in. Dunn, who's won so much in the air today, heads it away, and a chance of a counter-attack for the 10 men, but Barton can't find the pass, and it's won back by George Thorne. Chance here for Derby, shot from distance from Hendrick, rebounds away off Charlie Austin, who's playing like a midfielder now, and goes out for a throw into Derby on the far side. It's 5 live from the BBC. It's very nervous atmosphere around Wembley. Both sets of supporters actually rather quiet, just studiously watching this game. Derby nil, Queen's Park Rangers nil. Good feet from Ward down below us. He's got away from Traore. Traore recovers well. It's a corner. Corner to Derby on the right-hand side. Robbie Savage.
And you want better delivery. I think the corners, and Phil will tell you, so important. Derby set pieces have been very, very poor. You know, hitting the first man, but you've got to say the two defenders in Onua and Dunn and Clinton Hill, when he was on, defended exceptionally well.
Here comes the corner, played in by Ward, and once again Queen's Park Rangers are able to deal with it. The ball is headed well clear of the penalty area, and Derby must build again from the halfway line, but their players remain up around the penalty area. This is Dawkins, the substitute, passes back into midfield to Bryson. Now he's got a chance to look up for the first time, the evidence of tired legs from Queen's Park Rangers as they try to cover all the options. Ward again tries a little nutmeg on Traore. Traore stands his ground. The Frenchman is being fouled, and that's a free kick to Queen's Park Rangers, and that relieves a little bit of pressure for them. 0-0 on 5 live.
Yeah, good defending that time from Traore. You know, Ward's had the beating of him, but he stood up well, used his strength, you know, against the smaller man, and done defending exceptionally well for the team. I'd love to hear Phil's thoughts now. When you're the manager with the 10 men, you know, what do you do? You just think, listen, let's get to extra time, and, you know, because or get a set piece, because going forward they've offered absolutely nothing. Charlie Austin on the left hand side, he's not going to be involved in the play that much. So
12 minutes of the 90 remaining. Are we set for extra time at Wembley in this Championship playoff final? That's a poor clearance at the back by Forsyth. If Queen's Park Rangers were to score now, what an atmosphere there would be at Wembley, having absorbed so much pressure since being reduced to 10 men. I mean, even before the red card, Derby had been on top in the early stages of the second half. But I'd love to see the statistics for the possession for the last 20 minutes, because it feels like it's been all Derby. Here comes Buxton over the halfway line. Sends a ball very far in front of Forsyth, but he's got there. What an effort to send it across, but the goalkeeper Robert Green was able to get it ahead of the attacker. Decent counter-attacking again, though. Swift attacking down that left-hand side. The ball had actually gone out of play from Forsyth before he set the cross into the middle, and that will be a throw-in for Queen's Park Rangers. The final 10 minutes approaching. Derby fans bouncing and twirling scarves in the air away to our right. To our left in the sunshine, the Queen's Park Rangers support, waving flags, still knowing they're in it, but they've made it difficult for themselves with that red card for Gary O'Neill. It is still 0-0. Here is Dawkins, midway inside the Queen's Park Rangers half, plays it low to the edge of the penalty area to Martin. Now it comes back to Thorne, tries a left-footed shot, comes off the feet of Richard Dunn, and Queen's Park Rangers are able to clear away.
Yeah, you know, Derby, you can't get involved in shooting from, you know, distance. You just be patient what they're doing, trying to get the ball out wide. You fall back and overlap, you know, you're outnumbering them. Just be patient in the play. But you've got to say, QPR defending so, so well. Two banks of four, no space in between the lines. You know, defending exceptionally well, but get the ball wide.
A reminder, Champions League final, Atletico Madrid against Real Madrid at 7:45. Derby cross again from the left. And those crosses haven't created enough chances, really, for Derby. The amount of possession they've had in wide areas, and more often than not, any crosses either taken by the goalkeeper or more often than not headed away by Richard Dunn. Let's bring Phil Brown in again. It's become very interesting tactically, Phil.
Oh, it's fascinating, Connor. Absolutely fascinating. And you know, sometimes you come to watch a game of football for the beautiful side of it, you know, all the great passing and the movement and stuff like that. And other things galvanise you, and great defending galvanises me. And what you've got is almost like a siege mentality from the QPR sec. You've got the two banks of four, and like Robbie's saying, no space in between. But look how deep Bobby Zamora is. They're hanging on for Grimm, just waiting for that opportunity in the last 10 minutes. And it might come from a set play, it might come from counter-attacking football. But at this moment in time, you've got to admire the resolve of the 10 men against the 11 at this moment.
Yep. Derby County nil, 10-man QPR nil. And this is George Thorne for Derby, midway inside the half. Oh, he's played a good ball into the penalty area. Dawkins back onto his right foot. Oh, he turned in too wide of an arc, and he allowed the defenders to close him down. Derby still have possession, but that was a big, big opportunity for Dawkins. Here on the edge of the box he is again. Lays the ball back to Bryson now. Again, it's only really Martin in the centre, the rest of them lurking outside the penalty area. Martin is standing on the penalty spot. This is Dawkins now. QPR needs to get closer to him, and the ball is played out towards Wisdom. It's a terrible pass, and Wisdom's not going to be able to keep it in play. And I think Phil is right. Queen's Park Rangers have been giving themselves a difficult task, but they're performing it well, defending deep with 10 men.
Magnificent defenders from Queen's Park Rangers. You know, nothing going forward. They look tired, but they galvanise, and they're playing for their mate, they're playing for each other. But there, Derby going forward, you know, Wisdom's got to stay out wide. There's no point getting sucked in into the middle of the park. Stay out wide, keep transferring the ball. You know, be patient, keep saying it, because a chance will come.
One of the most lucrative games in world sport, and it's still on a knife edge. Derby with the extra man advantage, but just lately, their chances of goal are beginning to dry up. Here's Dawkins on the left-hand side. Sips is putting pressure on him. Dawkins standing his ground. He's done well here, actually. And it's taken a succession of players to eventually crowd him out of it. And Dawkins commits a foul. And that's a free kick to Queen's Park Rangers. And this is where Harry Redknapp's team need their experienced players. Guys like Carl Henry, Joey Barton, Richard Dunn. He's been there, done that. And Steve McLaren, we're now seeing on our monitors. Is this to be a happy return to Wembley for the former England manager, who famously lost his job here in 2007 for the England setup?
Well, now all the pressure on Derby. Everybody now expects them to win. So the nerves, Steve McLaren must be under there and his staff, because one set piece with 6 or 7 minutes to go from QPR would be a chance. So all the pressure now, expectations on Derby to go on and win this game. You know, so QPR now are probably thinking, do you know what? What have you got to lose?
Yeah,
I know they got to lose a lot. Obviously, win the Premier League, but in terms of
but no one's going to blame them at this stage.
But in terms of this game now, Noldy gives them a chance.
Martin tries to get in around the back of the defence, but Inua and Dunn have marshalled him very well so far this afternoon. A poor clearance from Dunn has come off the outside of his boot, and that goes out for a throw. But at least he cleared his lines. Throw into Derby.
The way this game's gone, there'll be nobody watching. Probably even QPR fans will be thinking now, you know, are we going to go and really win this game? Derby have been better in possession. Yes, they've created nothing. Down to 10 men.
Now here's a chance in the penalty area. Bryce is making a charge. He's done well to keep it in play by the byline. Gives it back into Dawkins. Good first touch. This is Forsyth. Pushes towards the byline again. Dawkins tries to come and attack it. And the ball goes out. And that will be a free kick to Queen's Park Rangers. And that relieves pressure for them.
Brilliant defending from Inua there. Great defend from QPR on a hole. But Bryson, again, he made the run. You know, done exceptionally well to keep the ball in. But quality from Derby in that final third, cutting the ball back, going back to all the chances in the game. The only moment of real quality in the final third was from Traore on this left-hand side when he cut the ball back to Austin, who had the best chance of the game.
Just a reminder, the Heineken Cup final, the Millennium Stadium, starts at 5 o'clock, Toulon against Saracens, and we'll be joining for commentary once we've had a conclusion of this game. If it ends in the 90 minutes, we'll be there virtually at kickoff. If it goes into extra time, we'll have to have a delayed start for our rugby commentary. Here's a chance down the left-hand side for Derby. Not a good cross, though, from Bryson, who had a chance to look up. He had Ward in the middle, and he played in a low, weak cross, and it's cleared away.
He could have took another touch. He seen Ward at the corner of his eye. He tried to whip it in between the goalkeeper and the back four. He could have run on. It was two against one. Poor decision from Bryson.
So 3 minutes being added on here at the end of the 90 minutes. 87,348 is the attendance. Derby have the possession. They have the extra man. They don't have a goal. It's nil-nil on 5 live. Here's a cross in from the left hand side. Once again, Richard Dunn lunges himself into the air, and a booming header goes all the way out to the halfway line, where Derby pick it up on a pose. And it's played forward now by George Thorne. And this is Bryson, the substitute. Little 1-2s on the edge of the D. Now the chance of a shot, which comes in low and hard, but bounces up from Hendrick and into the arms of the goalkeeper, Rob Green. And it remains nil-nil, and extra time is drawing closer.
Yeah, I think it was the wrong decision again. You know, Jamie Ward's in acres of space. He's shaking his head, get the ball to Ward. You know, they're starting to shoot now and panic Derby from, you know, 20, 30 yards, and they don't need to.
It's been a long time since Queen's Park Rangers had a chance, but with Zamora and Austin on the pitch, you feel if one chance was to fall for them, they might well take it.
He didn't convert the one he should have, Charlie Austin.
Yeah.
And now he's playing the left-hand side. You know, Zamora's not got a kick, and to be fair, he's isolated on his own. He's, you know, QPR haven't been in Derby's half for ages but defensively, they've been absolutely outstanding.
Well, the stewards are bringing out their end-of-match positions, and there's a rope that they use to protect the players if they're walking up to collect the trophy. And they're all getting in position should there be a late winner in the regulation time here. Ball played by Ward. Good ball into the penalty area, well intercepted by Traore, and it's cleared away. Derby get it back again. Out to Ward on the right-hand side. Ward looks up. Oh, good dummy there. That bought him a little bit of time. Sends him the cross. Martin jumps, beaten in the air, though, by Green. And the ball is cleared away.
Yeah, when you put the ball into the box, you've got to have quality. And too many balls are going to the box where Green's come from comfortably. He's been outstanding, Rob Green, today, with so many good saves. He's been confident when the ball's come into the box. Done a new ahead in the ball out. But you know, just want that extra bit of patience, quality, when the ball goes into the box. Because for all Derby's possession, I can't think of one clear-cut chance. Yes, the goal's clear, goal's got opportunity when he got sent off for Neil. Other than that, Austin's had the best chance of the game.
Yeah. Well, Bryson had the opportunity, saved at the near post by Green. Here come Queen's Park Rangers over the halfway line with Carl Henry. We have just less than 2 minutes of normal time to go. There will be 3 minutes added on for stoppages. There could yet be a twist in this tale. Dunn plays the ball forward, direct ball, looking for Zamora, who doesn't get a touch. Now Barton goes for goal from a long way out. He kept it low, but not on target. And Joey Barton fires wide, and that is the first shot of any nature that Queen's Park Rangers have had since they've gone down to 10 men.
But if you defend like they have been, you're going to create an opportunity. And Joey Barton there, 25 yards out, why not have a shot? You know, but they look tired, QPR. You know, Harry's saying, get turned, face the ball up. You know, we've got another 2 or 3 minutes left to defend to get to extra time.
This is Andre Wisdom, just over the halfway line for Derby. And we could be looking at half an hour of extra time to be played here to decide who goes up to the Premier League next season. Good interception there by Hoylett, wide on the right-hand side. Gives it up to Zamora. Queen's Park Rangers just being brave here. They've committed 4 players up into an attacking position, and the ball goes out of play, and that will be a throw into QPR attacking down the right-hand side. They're attacking the end where their fans are housed, and most of that has been long-distance viewing down to the other end of the pitch and seeing how their players have defended in this second half for QPR fans. Hoylett's lunged in. Oh, he's done very well. He's won it by the byline. Derby have got lots of defenders back. Here's the cross. Oh, they've dealt with it terribly, and Bobby Zamora scores the goal. That might well put Queen's Park Rangers into the Premier League next season. They have played with 10 men. They've absorbed all the pressure, and they've taken it into the final minute of the 90 to get the goal. Bobby Zamora, poor defending, you have to say, from Derby. And the 10 men are set to beat the 11 men, and Queen's Park Rangers believe they're going back.
It was Jake Buxton in the tackle with Hoylett. He done absolutely magnificent. And it was Keogh. What is he doing? He side-footed the ball into Zamora's path. what a finish from Bobby Zamora. That's the quality the game's been itching for, and it's Zamora. And you've got to say, Harry Redknapp, he brought him on at a time when the game was, you know, in the balance, and he's been paid off. What a finish from Zamora. Can you believe it? Football, I said it. One chance. There it is.
Incredible scenes at Wembley, where Queen's Park Rangers supporters have suddenly been awoken from their slumber. They have been up against it for almost all of this second half, playing with 10 men, digging in deep and defending. But we mentioned it, the quality of the strikers, and Bobby Zamora's finish there oozed class. A little adjustment of his feet to open up his body, and no goalkeeper in the world would say it. Just brushed against the post on its way in. That's how accurate it was. Tucked into the corner, and a goal worthy of winning a game of this stature.
Yeah, and do you know what? It's come from the defending. As Phil mentioned, they've been magnificent defensively. Rob Green's made some crucial saves, and that one chance fell to the right man, Zamora. What an absolute calm, brilliant finish, but terrible defending from Keogh and Buxton at the back there for Derby.
Steve McLaren's had a final throw of the dice. He's brought on striker Patrick Bamford, who's on loan from Chelsea, but surely too little too late. Look at Harry Redknapp, he's on the pitch, he's trying to get his message across, what he wants to, the team to do. Queen's Park Rangers have hardly had a kick in their opponent's half since being reduced to 10 men, and they've taken that one chance when it came their way. And while the Queen's Park Rangers defenders have been sharp, because they've been the busiest defence in this game, you've got to say Derby have shot themselves in the foot. Defenders who've not had to defend for long, long periods, and then suddenly they're, I mean, you said it, Robbie, that, you know, suddenly they're called upon and they've switched off.
Yeah, I said it, you have to be switched on, you have to be on it all the time, because you are going to get one chance. It fell to Zamora, and it's Keogh who's sort of whacking it into Rose there. He's passed it into Zamora's path, but you can't take anything away from the finish. What an outstanding finish. But Derby, all the possession, all the play, you know, but you've got to say this could be the best ever playoff final for QPR to come back against all odds. Well done, QPR.
Harry Redknapp is very agitated on the sidelines. His team are in front, but he knows it's not over yet. Long ball played forward by Thorne. One in the penalty area. This is Bamford. Bicycle kick, but it's away off target. It took a deflection. It's a corner to Derby. Look at their supporters getting on the feet, punching the air. None of them have left. Their team is behind, deep in stoppage time, but they're all staying here. Even the goalkeeper has come forward. Lee Grant up in the penalty area. Look at him waving his arm. Give it to me, he says, the big goalkeeper. It's going to be George Thorne to send in the corner. This needs to be perfect. Oh, it flashes across. There's still a chance. Left footed shot over the crossbar, and that might well be the final opportunity. Oh, it was well off target by Richard Keogh, the man whose mistake gave the chance for the goal to Bobby Zamora down the other end. And Richard Keogh might well have rectified his error, but his shot was atrocious and way, way off target.
You can't say hard enough for these cute Queen's Park Rangers player. They have been absolutely outstanding. Defensively, but unbelievable.
There is the final whistle at Wembley. And it is a sweet, sweet victory for Queen's Park Rangers, who have had their backs to the wall for a long period in this game, playing with 10 men, absorbing pressure, defending like demons, and then Bobby Zamora took his chance in the very 90th minute of the game. It's an immediate bounce back to the Premier League for Queen's Park Rangers, and Derby, their players and their supporters have been absolutely shell-shocked. They thought it was in their hands. They thought they had one foot back in the Premier League. Derby County are down and out, and they are in tears.
Well, what can you say? It's incredible. You've got to say QPR are absolutely outstanding. The way they defended, they defended every ball, but the moment of quality which the game was crying out for, and that man Bobby Zamora with a fantastic finish, give Harry Redknapp huge amounts of credit.
Let's quickly get out to the pitch, Juliet Farrington.
I've got all the Queen's Park Rangers players in front of me. I'm going to see if I can just grab. He's absolutely hugging everyone. you've been tested this afternoon?
Yeah, we have a habit of doing it the hard way, and there's ever an hard way to do a game.
Yes, mate. Sean Wright, Phillips now hugging him as well. There's a lot of man love going on this pitch.
To do a game. We were going to do it. I feel sorry for Derby. They played fantastic today, you know. It's football, you know. I mean, on the balance of it, they probably deserve to win. You know, they kept the ball really well.
But you say about this is the best game to win, the worst game to lose. You were down to 10 men as well.
Yeah, I feel for them, you know. I really do. I mean, that could have been us. And, you know, they're a great footballing side. And they're young enough to bounce back. They've got a great coach, great supporters base. You know, unfortunately, there has to be one loser. And we'll make the most of it. You know, we've found a way all season. Everyone's wrote us off. Derby were everyone's favourites.
Everyone,
the neutrals probably wanted Derby to win, but you know, there's some team spirit here. To go down to 10 men and win a game of football, magnificent. The boys deserve everything they get from it. I mean, look at this. This is what it's about, Juliet.
It is.
Come
Jeremy,
on.
A big hug there, Joe Barton. I'll let you go. Thanks for the hug, love. It was wonderful. Right, do you want to see if I can just find someone else? Nader Manua. I'll go get another hug if possible. Nader Manua, don't swear. You're back in the Premier League. You said to me earlier you thought you just might do it.
Yeah, I'm absolutely delighted. I think with the amount of experience we've got in the team, even in adversity, I think we're always going to have a second game plan. And today it was hard because Derby played so well, but to get the result, it just feels fantastic.
And to have a player sent off as well to score a late mini winner. You can't make these playoff finals up, can you?
It's ridiculous. I think we must love to do things the hard way, but, you know, it means twice as much now.
It's so difficult to bounce back in the Premier League the season after you've been relegated. Just sum up this season.
It's been really hard. The amount of games playing Saturday, Tuesday, and there's some good sides here as well. For example, Derby haven't gone up. They're one of the best sides we've played this season, so it's been difficult, but thankfully we're on the other side.
And there's a lot of man love here, isn't there?
There's plenty. Nothing like winning with your friends, is there?
Chance, Nadim, enjoy the afternoon. Thanks very much. Congratulations.
Thank you very much, Juliet. She extricated herself from the Joey Barton hug. There's nothing like winning with your friends, Phil Brown. What a fantastic quote from Nader Manua.
It is. It's a brilliant quote, and you know, it summed up the emotion that's spilling onto the pitch there. Look at one end and look at the other end. It's amazing. The contrast is there for everybody to see. And I talked about big players, and I think at the end of the day, that's what's won the game for QPR. Big players. And I don't mean big players scoring great goals and playing great football.
Rob Green, Richard Dunn,
absolute
Nader Manua.
1,000,000%. Big players standing up when it's needed to be, and they all stood up to be counted. And all the good football at Derby were playing, they were knocking at the door, ran out of ideas, and all QPR had to do was wait for that moment, and that moment came in the 90th minute.
QPR have changed out their red and black shirts that they've worn for this playoff final. They're putting blue and white hooped ones on at the moment. Robbie Savage, normally in a playoff final you see or in a cup final you see the losing fans disappear very quickly. Those Derby fans have stayed and have applauded their young side, and they are a young side, and they will learn from this.
Yeah, they will. I don't think they'll have a better opportunity, Chappers, over the years to come, to get up against 10 men, get all the play. Yes, they didn't create chances. QPR went in their half at all, and as you and Phil rightly say, big players for QPR, experience. But I've got to say, it was shocking defending, you know, let's be fair, from Derby. First Buxton in a 50-50 with Hoylett, and then for Keogh to side-foot the ball into Zamora's path. It was awful defending. They're upset, you know, because they should have won the game, there's no doubt about it, and I don't think they'll get a better chance.
And we brought Joey Barton's reaction to you here on 5 Live, and I wonder when people listen to that, whether they might just change their opinion of Joey Barton, because his first thought was with the Derby points.
Yeah, wonderful. I mean, it just shows you what the man is. I know he courts controversy, and he is a big player. And strangely enough, me and Robbie were talking about, you know, holding the ability to hold himself together when you cross the white line. And then his midfield partner's the one that gets the red card. If anybody's waiting for a red card, you would always think Joey Barton. But no, he's held himself in high regard, in high esteem, and making reference to Derby County. First thing that came out in his head just sums up the man.
If you wonder what this game means, I'm just looking at local radio colleagues from Derby. They are in tears at the moment at what has happened this afternoon. QPR down to 10 men midway through the second half after Gary O'Neill made a professional foul, brought down the last man, Johnny Russell, on a goal-scoring opportunity. As one member of the press has written, looks like Gary O'Neill made a £100 million foul, the richest red card in the history of football. Bobby Zamora scored in the 89th minute. QPR are heading back to the Premier League. We are heading to Cardiff very shortly. The Heineken Cup final is next on this astonishing day of sport here on 5 Live. First of all, the latest BBC news from Laura Harms.
Officials in Brussels say three people have been killed in a shooting at the city's Jewish museum. A fourth person has been seriously injured. The Belgian foreign minister has expressed shock at the incident. We'll keep you updated on this through the evening on 5 Live. Relatives of the four British yachtsmen feared dead in the Atlantic have spoken of their sadness. The search for the crew was called off after the US Coast Guard discovered the overturned hull of the boat. And Vladimir Putin's described Prince Charles's reported comparison of him with Hitler as unacceptable. The Russian president said the remarks are not what monarchs do.
Thank you very much, Laura. QPR players just heading towards their Derby counterpart, shaking their hands. Steve McLaren shaking the hands of all the QPR players as well. We'll go to Cardiff after we go to Wentworth for an update on the PGA from Ian Carter.
And a very tight leaderboard here with 16 players within four shots of the lead, held by the Irishman Shane Lowry, who's one over par for his round, just teeing off at the 11th at 9 under, one ahead of Thomas Akin, Thomas Bjorn, the overnight leader, and Luke Donald, who is at 8 under par, one shot behind. As for Rory McIlroy, he's at 5 under par, four shots behind.
Thank you very much, Ian. 11:30 tonight if you want to see what's happened here on the Football League show. We'll bring you more reaction on 5 Live throughout the evening. You'll hear from Steve McLaren, you'll hear from Harry Redknapp as well. At 7:45, full coverage from Lisbon of the Champions League final between Real Madrid and Atletico.